Good morning. Welcome in. Hurrdat Sports Radio, AM 590, ESPN Omaha, ESPN Tri-Cities. That's DB. I'm Ravi Lulla here on the Pillar Exterior Stage. What's up, DB?
Well, apparently I'm not very strong. It's the cut on my finger. I couldn't grip it.
I just assumed because of the maturity level, the childproof locks don't work on you.
Yeah, I haven't seen one of these.
It's because you can flip it upside down, so it's not as easy to, like, it'll screw in upside down, so you don't have to deal with the, like, safety lock on it.
Uh-huh.
You know, it's just a little, I don't have kids around my house, so I'll sometimes use it without the safety lock, because I trust Natasha not to take pills she's not supposed to.
The way this little girl got up this morning, apparently I don't have kids around the house either.
You just got full-grown adults?
Man. I need to call, I give her a piece of my mind. I was in a hurry, man. Unlike some of these people around here, I tried not to jump to conclusions. We got some
wild people out here.
They just say anything.
Yeah.
It's like, man, you have any integrity or what?
Well, and you know it's bad when I think it's wild the things people are saying, because all a little bit say anything.
Yeah.
And then if I'm like, you guys are kind of out there, like, you might be a little bit out there. Mm. That's a thing that might be real.
Shane, how you doing?
I'm good. Thank you.
Did we enjoy the Jameis Winston experience last night?
No. So I will say this. I will say this. God told Jameis to bet on the Broncos.
Well,
he's trying to get the Lord to take away those pick sixes.
Lord said, Jameis, I'm going to provide you with the means to tithe. You're 10%. You can do it in one night. Do the best you can to take the Broncos. And Jameis said,
I got you.
He said, you strong, I'm strong. Lord, I got you.
Let's eat.
Feed some W's.
Yeah.
On the money line only.
He took that all the way to Warhorse.
He's like 6.5.
Oh, I can beat that.
No problem.
I can beat that.
You know, I'm going to tease you guys, too. And then at the very end, what I'm going to do is I'm going to roll out and I'm going to throw it to the guy
directly
in blue, because the jerseys were so close in color. He
has had vision problems in the past.
Yep,
DB.
Yep.
Here's the funny thing.
He should have went to go see my guy Kugler.
Is even if it gets past the guy that intercepted it on the goal line,
he ain't opening.
He's still not.
And why did he keep throwing it to the guy that can't catch? And Undrapu. Golly, you guys were in cahoots.
I think that maybe the Lord spoke to David as well. And
he's like,
he does have a history of speaking to David.
He's like, yeah. He's like, hey, man.
Njoku, I got you.
He's like, that whole slingshot thing. Watch how you show the world you can play with no hands. David's like, man.
The Lord works in mysterious ways, DB.
Yes, I am going to the valley to whoop that giant. Known as Sean Payton with the worst looks on television. My man always looks mildly disgusted.
Yeah, he does.
Doesn't he? He smelled something bad.
He's like one of those, did you ever meet these people who are like working in retail places or whatever, and they had to have a mask on for like 2 years, right?
Yeah.
And they
like future mask on?
Sure.
Percocet.
But
Percocet.
They kind of forgot how to disguise their faces for people that they were disgusted with in public.
Oh, so they just had the frowny face?
So when the mask came off and then people started asking them stupid questions and you could see their face again,
yeah,
it was pretty funny. That's Sean Payton constantly.
Bro, that was
constantly.
That was a highly, highly entertaining game.
It was.
And it was cool, too, because I could turn the Lakers off relatively early.
They helped you out there.
Yeah, once the T-Pups pushed it to like 9,
yeah,
it's a wrap. And then this was my favorite. Amid slump, LeBron James rethinking the 82-game slate. I'm like, thoughts. Can we at least get to Christmas?
We're 20 games in. He's always like, this might be too many.
Can we get to Christmas?
How many games he want to play? Like 12?
I don't know, man.
He was playing like one a week? He wants to do a football schedule?
I just, my patience is just. Hey, by the way.
Him and AD going to play once a week.
Hey, do you want to see your boy's mindset?
What's up?
Are you sure?
Yeah.
All right.
What do we got today? Buffalo. Oh, okay. We're on the serial killer-ish today. Okay.
Buffalo Bills.
Body lotion. That's funny.
I'm funny.
That's pretty funny.
Just ask me.
I mean, funny's one word for it.
A perfume on and loche.
I will say.
Yeah, your boy is like.
Whatever.
What's worse than pins and needles?
Because
that's what I'm on.
I don't know. Maybe like a little Creed, like 6 feet from the edge. Mm. And you're thinking.
Maybe 6 feet ain't so far down. And I had to shower with no music.
No music this morning?
Nah.
What happened?
There's a lot happening. A
lot going on?
Yeah, man.
Too busy answering text messages in the shower to listen to music?
Bro, not one. So only two people of the 10 trillion texts yesterday,
mm-hmm.
only two people had the wherewithal to say, are you good?
Yeah.
Like, this isn't fun and games for me.
Yeah.
I'm not trying to get people to click on my TikTok and pay me money,
yeah.
right? This is, like, real.
Yeah, you're in it.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. You're multi-generational in it.
So you two people, thank you. Bless your hearts.
That's nice of them.
Yeah, your boy had to shut the old phone down. I didn't respond. So
probably for the best.
I didn't respond. So the first text that I responded to was mm-hmm. this morning at, I think, 5:05.
Yeah.
And it was not even, it was kind of Nebraska related, but it wasn't.
Yeah.
It was about his son.
Mm.
It was like.
Probably more important.
Well, you know, I'm a sucker for. Oh, I did respond to one guy last night.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's all right, you know? Gotta.
Yeah.
Occasionally.
I like his son, too. It's all about the kids. If that's how you gotta get to me.
You know who I met the other day, speaking of people's sons?
Who?
Darian Jones' dad.
Oh, D-Rock?
Yeah.
Yeah, he's a good dude.
So
he's a funny, low-key son of a gun.
He stopped me at one of the Creighton games.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. He is an attendee.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He pulled me. I was like, hey, what's going on, man? And I'm like, hey, what's up? And
apparently, I need to get on his payroll because I worked in administration
yeah.
in the district, and I couldn't gallivant around the country like he does. My man has played on about 226 million courses. He's constantly traveling.
Yeah.
I'm like, I had to move out of his neighborhood.
you might be like, hey, bud, what's going on here?
Nah, he's a good dude, man.
Maybe they got some of them bonds passed or something, making yeah. that.
he, like you could tell, good the stock, like the boys.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, actually, it might be Jill. It might be his wife too. So I gotta give.
Can't take all the credit there.
Hey, shout out to all the moms out there investing in their kids.
Yeah, it was a brief interaction, but he seemed like a cool dude.
He's funny.
He seemed like a good dude.
That's one of those dudes probably like 12 or 15 years ago. Mm-hmm. He probably didn't like me, or he didn't really know me. And
yeah.
I'm like, I'm on his turf. Like, I'm coming over to North.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, what's this dude doing?
I got to tread carefully.
You know, we're both brothers trying to be in administration. But no, he is.
Like, you're related or?
Yeah. Yeah. You're an idiot. You're picking up where you left off from Lawrence and Gardens last night. But I want to choke the life out of you. Full disclosure, I was suffering from heartburn, too.
Were you?
Yeah, I took Alka-Seltzer. I almost said Alta-Seltzer.
Altoids?
Yeah, I have those.
Yeah.
Maybe that's why. Those are acidic.
Are they? Yeah.
Yeah, so I had serious heartburn.
You look like you weren't. You
in
look
a very
like
good
you were
mood.
Struggling a little bit.
Yeah.
You seem very hurt right now.
Not happy.
I was trying to lighten the mood a little bit.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Good thing for everybody else because you weren't doing it.
That's all I got when somebody's in distress is trying to lighten the mood.
Man down. Man down. Man in distress.
I was going to make jokes and hope it helps.
It turned out to be funny, though.
It apparently did not.
That's all good.
It's all right. Just for the record, I did ask if you were okay yesterday. Not over text, but when we were at Lawrenson.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I got you.
Fudge.
Even if you didn't like my jokes very much.
Oh, they suck.
How are the older guys going to take it?
Exactly. The only non-dad I know with dad jokes.
Well, listen, I thought they might appeal to you on your level. You know, I was trying to meet people where they're at.
Oh, now you're using my line. It's fine. I see what we're on today. It's fine. Giddy up.
Well, listen, it was
I'm scorching everybody else while I'm at it.
It was a little bit of a hectic Monday, you know, so try to.
Just another hectic Monday.
So close.
Yeah.
You're almost
like
there.
Like old Ricky and Mickey and Nicky?
Not Not quite last night. We got in an argument, but it's close.
Speaking, that should be the words. Knock it off. Because, you know, I mean, full disclosure, the backstory, and I'm sure we want to get to Nebraska and gossip. But one thing you're not going to get here is gossip. This isn't going to be like, oh, I heard. I'm either going to tell you this is my opinion or I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you know what? Hey, you guys and gals, you need to put this part on. Stop trying to go through kids and hanger-oners to get information. Trust me, they don't always know.
Yep.
Just don't, like, that's just wrong.
Yeah.
Just wrong.
Well, you're putting the kids in a bad spot.
And they don't know any better. You know, kids trickle stuff to their families, mm-hmm. and then the families get hit up. They don't know.
Yeah.
Like, believe me, it's wild out here.
Yeah, I mean, you're taking advantage of kids or people that don't know any better yet, and that's kind of messed up.
Stop staring at me.
It's not great. We don't like that.
No more staring?
No.
Also, to be fair, most of these people probably don't know what's going on anyway.
It's
like if stuff hasn't actually happened yet, mm-hmm. then nobody knows what's happening.
Yeah.
Right? There's two things that we know for sure.
Huge shakeup. So little did I know. Mm-hmm. Well, I kind of knew, but I didn't know. You know, my Benning Bites was, and I said yesterday, hey, you know, big things are happening. It's mm-hmm. going to be a bloodletting. It's definitely a bloodletting.
Yeah.
It is continuing. Somebody needs to get this thing a tourniquet.
Maybe not yet. There's probably a little bit left to do.
Yes, indeed.
I mean, so here's the things we know for sure. Tony White's gone.
Yes.
Dana Holgerson staying.
Correct.
I think that's the only thing that's official so far.
Yes.
There's been reports.
Correct.
That Garrett McGuire won't be retained.
Yes.
That hasn't been announced officially yet, but it comes from reporting that I trust. Mm-hmm. And there were reports early that Terrence Knight was going to Florida State with him. Reports late, we're not sure yet.
Yeah.
That's basically where it's at for the coaching staff.
The only thing I know is he was at the meeting last night.
Okay.
So do with that what you will.
That is, for the coaching staff, that's where we're at, right? We don't know anything else yet?
That is correct.
Now, we can speculate of, maybe you need to make it. We mentioned Barthel yesterday, that like maybe that's a place you look at, right? I think it depends on.
Can I ask something, though, real quick?
For sure.
Because I don't really know that situation, and I like EJ.
Mm-hmm.
What do we have against EJ again?
So here's where I think it comes down to for most people.
Okay.
Is if he is in charge of the running back rotation, people are upset that Emmett Johnson didn't play earlier.
Okay.
That's the gripe. Because otherwise, I think you look at the recruiting. You know, Jamarion Parker is a good get. It's a really good get for him. Being able to get Dante Dowdell in here as a transfer is a good get. Mm. I think the development of the running backs has been solid. I mean, maybe Emmett Johnson was always going to be this. Maybe he wasn't. I don't know. But Emma Johnson's looked really good. I thought Dowdell got better throughout the season, although I do have to attribute some of that to Holgerson because they lined up that way. But I honestly think it's the running back rotation.
Yeah. I mean.
And I don't know who's doing that. I don't know if that's coordinators or if that's EJ.
I always have to ask myself in situations like this. It's like self.
Mm-hmm. That's dangerous.
Oh, I know. Somebody was making fun of me the other day, and I was like, man, you should try being me. Fudge. That sucks. No, you know, you got to always ask yourself, like, how close to this do I want to be?
Sure.
Right. And
because there's a burden a little bit with knowledge and information, or there can be.
Yeah, sure. I mean, that's one way to look at it. That's one vantage point.
Maybe responsibility is a better word than burden.
Elaborate.
Well, I mean, if you're given the gift of knowledge and information and access, you have an obligation to do that responsibly, and in a way
right.
that you're not.
I do think people trust me.
Yeah, in a way that you're not burning bridges, in a way that you're not betraying people's confidences. Because a lot of, at least from what it seems like, a lot of the things that you get told are not as DB radio host. It's DB, you know, friend, confidant, former player, whatever. You get told things in roles that people wouldn't expect you to share those things. Where if they share it with somebody who's a radio host, they expect that to be shared or have some reasonable expectation that that's going to be made public. Mm. And so you kind of wear these different hats that makes it challenging. and people do trust you kind of despite that because you are responsible with the information.
Yeah, and I think most importantly, like I have family involved.
Yeah.
So that changes the dynamics tremendously. That's almost why I got out of the business.
Mm-hmm.
But then I convinced myself, oh, I can handle it.
How's this week treating you?
Oh, competitive stamina, gamification.
Endure.
Let's endure. Let's hang in there. I can do this. I'm not a quitter.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. No, but you can learn a lot from a dummy. So, like, learn from me. Because
mm-hmm.
I am a conduit for perspective. That's it.
Yeah?
Yeah. That's all I got. That's all I got. It's all I could do. So I think first and foremost, I have to decide who I'm officially going to cut off because that's going to happen.
Mm.
It's going to be like this pruning process. Like, you're just not good for the greater good. You're good for you.
Mm-hmm.
So those people got to go bye-bye. Then it's how involved do I get versus just letting this thing play out? Because just because I can see something coming or I may feel a certain way does not mean that everybody sees it the same way I do in my family.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know do I want this to be Custard's last stand? Do I just want to let this play out? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, it's not fun and games.
No.
Right? Especially.
I mean, you have real stakes.
Yeah.
Like, you have real stakes involved.
Yeah, 100%.
And that makes it a totally different thing than what any of the rest of us are doing.
Yeah.
No matter how responsible I try and be or other people try and be.
And you are incredibly irresponsible.
Yeah, just in general. Like, I that's mean, my just, default setting. It's just
irresponsible.
To burn it to the ground.
So, wait a minute. Is that like full or empty? F or E?
Usually it's F.
R and I?
Usually it's F as in F it. We're going to be irresponsible.
No, I get it. God, I've linted my nail. That's from scraver mine.
You probably need to get that cleared out there.
Yeah, so I think the transition and the bloodletting that I talked about is going to be substantial.
Mm-hmm.
And like with most transfusions, and take this with a guy that just with aplastic anemia. With most transfusions, they don't feel good.
Mm-hmm.
A lot. Sometimes it's a slow process. And
probably gotta feel a little worse before you feel better.
But I don't know how bad we should feel in the meantime. Like
with the news so far or in general?
So the news so far is okay.
I agree.
The news so far is okay. And I think this is my opinion.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like that's important. I feel Coach Rule was caught a little bit off guard.
With Tony White?
Yeah.
Mm.
I think Coach White had a couple of head coaching interviews.
Mm.
But I think Florida State was a little bit out of left field.
It's a weird move. Because, I mean, I would.
Why are you over here?
Our clock's not working.
Well, no, I just want to. No, I want him to tell me. This is going to be some week.
It's going to be fun. It's going to be a fun week.
Fun. Is that the word you're using?
Yeah.
Look, there we can see his little big head on the camera. Oh. Hey, do you guys like Shane's little fingers? They're like white Vienna sausages. I don't even know. Like, how do you drink pop out of a can? Can you actually get your fingers around a pop can?
Yeah.
Okay.
Like a full-size adult one or like the little mini ones to give to the kids?
No, Listen, I got myself a sugar-free Canada Dry Mini.
Yeah?
Yesterday.
Well, why? Why would you do that?
Well, you know, I like ginger ale.
Yeah.
But I'm not on soda.
Okay.
So,
is ginger ale technically soda?
Yeah.
Does it count?
Yeah.
Okay.
So I opened it, and I drank it as fast as I could.
So it didn't count?
Isn't it weird how I convinced myself of that? I know you're being funny, and I really like to step on your face, but... Because the funny thing about that
is exactly what you thought.
Yeah. It is 100% what I thought.
You're like, if the faster I drink it, it doesn't count.
Dumbest thing ever, but it seems to make sense to me. That's fine. So, yeah.
So, you think Rule was caught off guard by Tony White?
I do.
By the Florida State thing specifically.
Yeah, and I'm
not necessarily that he's going to leave.
And by the way, I appreciate the programming announcements. We'll try to overlap the shows tomorrow to cover recruiting.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to get your national guy at 9:45. I will be in Lincoln to start at 7 o'clock with the Husker Radio Network. And I will miss my own school signing, which kept me up.
Yeah.
So shout out to the guy that got the text at 5:04 this morning. It's easy to send those texts when you're not very tired. You know, because it's a conundrum.
Yeah.
Right? I had to talk to a lot of the guys yesterday and let them know. Like,
well, yes, you're invested, obviously.
I am, very much so. And my head coach isn't in the building.
Mm, yeah.
We have so many good coaches over there. It's cool, I hope.
Yeah.
Plus, they get to Zoom with Coach Simonji this morning.
Oh, that's good.
7:15.
Nice.
Yeah, so he is.
I'll say probably right now then.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah. He's at home doing better.
Good. He got released from the hospital?
Yeah, came home Thanksgiving.
Good.
So, back to... I get the sense. Now I'll go back and see if I can figure out the whole different part of it. But
like the mechanics
from Coach Rule's aspect of it. But that's not one of those things that, you know, I think he and I that I would enjoy talking about.
Mm.
It's very you just want to guard those boundaries.
Sure.
You got to remember, it's not jeopardizing a relationship. It is, you coach my kid.
Mm, yeah.
So think that dynamic first.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
It's very difficult. Because he and I have a much different relationship. And it's separate, but kind of equal.
Yeah.
Not to go back to the 60s and 70s. By the way, we could share drinking fountains. Did you know that there were two drinking fountains at Lawrence yesterday?
I saw one. You pointed one out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Separate but equal.
That was, well, there was one by the Elephant Crossing, which is kind of for my people over there. What timing on that break, Shano? Coming up on the show today, we've got quite a bit. We got John Walters, voice of Iowa State football. We've got Mike Gross, covering Penn State for Lancaster Online. We got Mike Schaefer from Husker 24/7 and Ryan Clarke covering Oregon for the Oregonian as we do a little whip around of conference championship week. That's DB. I'm Ravi Lulla. We'll be back with more Hurrdat Sports Radio. We're back here on Hurrdat Sports Radio, AM 590 ESPN Omaha, ESPN Tri-Cities. That's DB. I'm Ravi Lulla here at Hurrdat Sports Bar and Grill, where we're digging into a busy, busy start to the week for Nebraska.
I need clarification on something.
Yeah.
I guess we can, because we're both talking to him together. What do you think SkyMex means when he says compart with T. Farley?
Let me see.
How is he using compart?
I didn't see Farley's take on.
I didn't either.
Tony White. So that would be.
Help me out here, SkyMex.
I'm assuming he's using comport in the sense of, does that line up with, like, a line?
Oh, he thinks it. Oh, so it does align with.
I think that's what he's asking, if it aligns. Or no, that would align. Yeah, so he's saying it does align.
Oh, okay.
I think so.
Oh.
But I don't know what.
Yeah.
I don't know what.
Yeah,
Farley said.
If that's what T. Farley. I don't know, SkyMex, what T. Farley said. But it's not a Phil Snow thing.
No.
Like people have to stop. That's irresponsible.
I mean, didn't Rule literally tell us?
Listen, it's irresponsible.
That Snow's been
consulting
the whole year?
The whole cooks in the kitchen, it's irresponsible. Those guys never even saw Snow. I'm not telling you what I think.
Yeah, no, that's what Coach Rule said. He literally told us
and
that.
You don't have to take his word for it. Ask Coach White.
Oh, fair, yeah.
That's irresponsible.
Also, it would just be dumb to lie about something that could
everybody can hear.
Yeah, and also that you could any player could just be like, oh no, Phil Snow's been in the building.
Yeah, the cooks in the kitchen thing is the most sixth grade thing ever.
We've already talked about it. We've already talked about the cooks in the kitchen thing. It's dumb.
It's not a thing.
It's dumb.
God, my neck looks little. I need to
get that game day men's health going.
That's
what, you know,
I said, slouch. I don't know. It's a lot of information to process. Coach Knight was at the meeting last night. A lot of these guys want to get paid. You got to think about people's families.
Yeah, this is their career.
There's just a lot of moving parts. So the faster, and Lance said this best. He said one of the things that he tries to teach his kids is when things are gaining speed and kind of spiraling, slow down.
Take a step back.
And try to process all the information. You don't have to be first.
Just get it right.
Just get it right.
Yeah. Getting it right's way more valuable than being first.
And it's okay to say I don't know, because the information pool is so small and immediate.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it doesn't take long for bad games of telephone. You know what I mean? Because full disclosure, for whatever the reason, I just trust Coach Wool. And this is coming from a guy that, who was my first man crush on?
T. White.
Tony White.
Yeah. And I've got one on and Terrence Knighton.
Tony.
Yeah.
T. Knighton's going to be fine.
Yeah.
He'll be fine. Coach Rule has known T. Knighton since he was 17 years old. So whatever happens with Coach Knighton, Coach Rule and Coach Knighton will be on board together.
Sure.
They've been on Adam's show. Okay, I'm reading Sky Max. On Adam's show, he mentioned TW won't have any players to comp. Oh, I don't know. I'm not even going to say it.
My question from a career standpoint.
Sky Max, I'm just telling you, and it's not Farley. People can make you dumber. So I'm going to leave it at that.
Be careful who you listen to.
Man, incredible.
The thing I would wonder about from a career standpoint for Tony White is the Florida State part of this doesn't make sense to me. Because I'm sitting here as somebody that likes Florida State. Florida State's my college football side chick, right? Like, I like Florida State. I spent some time with her when, but I'm pretty familiar with the situation down there, right? Mike Norvell is firmly on a hot seat going into next year. I'm talking minimum 8 wins, probably 9 or more, to feel good about keeping his job next year. That is a more hostile, volatile situation than Nebraska. It just is. And you also go in and you go, okay, not really sure what Florida State's doing with the ACC. We're in a conference. You're going to be in a conference that hates them because they've been trying to get out and publicly embarrass you for the last 2 years. That's a fact. You're in a place where the money is weird. The money at Florida State is strange. They do not have all their ducks in a row. There might be money there, but nobody's rowing in the same direction. So that thing is not an ideal situation for NIL. It's not an ideal situation moving into revenue sharing next year. That is not an ideal situation. So you're going to a head coach that is in a more vulnerable position than you were at right now. You're going to a university where maybe you've got more access to local talent, but you're in a bad situation for who you think you are and who people think you should be.
Yeah.
To actually use money and resources. They're still behind on facilities, even though they've tried to upgrade those. The only thing I can think of that makes sense for Tony White to make that move to the ACC is he thinks the 3-3-5 will play better against ACC football. That's the only thing I can think of where I go, that makes sense. But it's not like the 3-3-5 has been terrible. Like, they've been a top 20 defense 2 years in a row. Have they had lapses? Sure. But is that keeping him from getting a head coaching job that he wants? I don't think so. I don't.
So.
And he turned down UCLA last year because of a messy financial situation. Mm-hmm. Now, I know he's not the head coach like he would have been at UCLA, but Florida State, and I get Florida State's not as messy as UCLA. Nobody is.
So what if it's not about money?
No, I mean just the money to be able to operate the way you want to.
What if it's not about money?
Then I would need to hear a good reason. Because if I'm just looking at it from a career standpoint, maybe he likes Florida, whatever. Maybe there's other things, personal things. I have no idea. But from a football career standpoint, there's not a lot of it that makes sense. I don't think.
No, you don't have to.
I don't think it makes sense. I think Florida State's a bad situation to be in right now.
I'm processing real time.
I like Gus Malzahn going there because he doesn't need it in his career. Right? But then I ask, okay, so, I was talking to Ryan about this yesterday. RP.
Yeah.
The Norvell situation is starting to feel a lot like the Scott Frost situation.
I feel bad. I think he thinks I was talking about him, but I wasn't. Like, and I just tell him, like, guys that are always for me, and he is always.
Yeah.
Like, he's a no-brainer. He doesn't have to check on me. That dude takes care of me like a babysitter. Nah, he's good. RP's good.
You know what I mean? So, like,
I'm just processing out loud real time. And this is what you get when you turn on the show, so whatever.
And I throw things at you that I didn't necessarily say we're going
to
talk about.
So the only thing that would get me to do something that doesn't make sense, and this is somebody that is even currently I don't even care. That is currently like in situations where finances aren't of the utmost, even though they could be different because of like your family situation.
Sure. Yeah.
Right. Like, I mean, if I wanted to go 80, like there's lots of things maybe that I could potentially do, but it's like, I'll be poor for a little while longer until I make sure the kids are good. Do you know what I mean? Or something like that. Or, you know, it's a, like what
sacrifice
I
sacrifice time. For
yeah.
Money.
Like what I think about is, you know, it's a lot. I won't get into me, but that would be the only thing that
extenuating circumstances, basically
with my family that could get me to do something that fiscally doesn't make sense for my career. You're looking at a testament.
Yeah. Like, right there, right in front of you. Yeah. But I also don't know that, like, I assume Tony White's going to get paid.
Yeah, but so we got to think, okay. We got to think about this like normal people for a second. How much is enough for the lifestyle that I need to be functional versus what I think as an outsider, as I judge somebody else about how much they should make?
I ask that question all the time. And
because I feel like we're putting things on T-Dub that aren't things that he's thinking about.
Right. And that's totally fair. I just sit here and I don't think he's making a financial sacrifice to be there. I think he's making a football situation sacrifice to be there. That's the part that doesn't make sense to me. Because I'd be shocked if Florida State doesn't make him whole as a salary, right?
Yeah. We're going to continue our championship preview whip. So give us 13 minutes to preview the championship weekend. We'll get back to this. There's a lot. It's going to be a long week. Plenty of fallout to come. I'm just going to say that right now.
John Walters, voice of Iowa State football, coming up next.
It's going to be a long week.
We got plenty of time. More Hurrdat Sports Radio coming up next.
Welcome to Hurrdat Sports Radio.
Spins and hands it off. Hansen takes it in for the touchdown. Carson Hansen with his first career touchdown. And Iowa State strikes first in this one. There's the snap. Fakes the handoff to Sama. Dumps it off left. Caught. This is Tyler Moore into the end zone for the Cyclone touchdown.
Wrapping up hour number one here on Hurrdat Sports Radio, AM 590, ESPN Omaha, ESPN Tri-Cities. That's DB. I'm Ravi Lulla. We're joined now by John Walters, the voice of Iowa State football. John, how are you this morning?
I'm doing well. How are you guys?
John, good to talk to you, buddy. You got to be living your best life, right? I mean, this is, as a Cyclone, you got a chance to be in the playoffs in a state where Iowa gets a lot of the headlines. You're like, could we be in the playoffs before Iowa? How about that? Like, I mean, not a bad time to be a Cyclone, right?
No, great time to be a Cyclone. And Matt Campbell has done some amazing things with this program. You know, Iowa State, since his second year at Iowa State, when he really kind of got it rolling, has won more Big 12 conference games than any other program in the league, you know? And so and by a margin of three over, you know, the likes of Kansas State and Oklahoma State and TCU. And so it's been a thing that's been growing and happening over time, and he's gotten it to where it's pretty consistently successful. Now, they took a step back a couple of years ago, but really it's been pretty good for a while. But this is different territory. Obviously, they made the Big 12 championship game in 2020. It was the COVID year. You couldn't have a lot of fans there. This trip's going to be a little bit different. You know, you're going to have a lot of Iowa State fans going down to Dallas and supporting the Cyclones against Arizona State. And so, and to get to that 10-win mark and get that monkey off your back, you know, it had been Iowa State, Indiana, and Vanderbilt that hadn't won 10 games in a regular season. That 2020 team probably would have if they had played a normal schedule, but they only played one non-conference game that year. They went 8-1 in the Big 12 and were alone atop the standings. But this is new, and 10 wins, get that over with. It had been Iowa State, Vanderbilt, and Indiana. This year, Indiana and Iowa State got that taken care of. It's, now it's just Vanderbilt's torch to carry, and I'm fine with that.
John, not to sound kind of cheesy or hokey, but very familiar with Iowa State. They recruit the high school I coach at extremely well, recruited my son very hard. Coach Haycock called last week when our head coach was had a bad diagnosis. So I understand the heart, right? The culture, the backbone of what Iowa State is. Is it safe? Do I just hear what I want to hear to say? Like, part of what Iowa State has been able to do in this portal-friendly NIL world is culture reigning supreme in Iowa State with just the camaraderie and the cohesiveness of what you guys seem to represent?
100%, because everybody's going to talk about culture. Every program in America has a culture. They're not all good cultures, you know, and Iowa State has a great culture, and it's a product of how much these coaches invest in these players and care about them. And because with Iowa State, you know, I think they had one Big 12 player of the week. It was Kyle Conrady when he made a 54-yard field goal to beat Iowa in Kinnick Stadium. That's it. They haven't had an offensive player of the week. They haven't had a defensive player of the week. He's been the only special teams player of the week in the Big 12. They have a lot of good players. They have a lot of really good players. But the sum of the parts is so much better than the parts. The parts are good, but the sum of the parts is what makes it special. And these guys understand that. They know they depend on each other. But these coaches, as you mentioned, that act that you mentioned by John Haycock, that's,
I mean, that's 2 days before you guys are landed on the line, he's calling on a Thursday night. It's incredible.
That's who he is. Yeah, that's who he is. And that's who Matt Campbell is. That's who these guys are. There's nothing phony about him. I mean, we even heard Kenny Dillingham, the Arizona State coach, say that yesterday. He likes the realness of Matt Campbell and feels like he is what he says he is. And I think players really like that. And you're right. We're in an era now where it's kind of like, hey, what's in it for me? You know, and you've got all these guys kind of pouring into each other. And football, the more I've done these games, this is my 22nd year calling Iowa State games on the radio. I did TV before that for a lot of basketball games and stuff. But the longer I'm around it, the more I feel like chemistry really is the most important piece of the puzzle. You know, you got to have talent, clearly. You have to have talent. But chemistry, if you don't have it, you got no chance. And I think this team has a great chemistry. They have great senior leadership. They have a bunch of young guys that also lead but look up to that senior class. And so I think this is a group of guys that have really kind of, as Matt Campbell's always saying, be the best version of yourself and try to max out who you are. I think they've come pretty close to doing that, you know. And so it's been a special season. And when times get tough, which they have many times during the season, they've kind of found a way to buck up and get through those times, and they do it together. So it all sounds kind of corny. I get it, but it's fact. And especially in football, where you got 110 guys and you're trying to get everybody rolling in the same direction, it's a really big deal to have that. And I think that's something that Matt Campbell and his staff really excel at. Mm.
We're talking with John Walter, the voice of Iowa State football. John, you know, you mentioned Matt Campbell and the kind of step back they took a couple of years ago. It seemed after he went on kind of that run of 8-9 win seasons, I think 3 out of the 4 years, they won at least 8 games in that stretch from 2017 to 2020. And it seemed like nationally the shine kind of came off him a little bit. You know, his name wasn't mentioned in jobs as much, and just seemed like people kind of got off of the Matt Campbell train. What was the perception kind of real time in Ames? Was there ever, I guess, any disillusionment after he'd reached a new level of success that things were kind of backsliding a little bit? Or what has been the feel around Matt Campbell kind of throughout his tenure?
I think those closest to the program understood that there were some circumstances that kind of maybe led to some of that stuff, and never doubted that he could get it back to the level he had it at, or even exceed that, which is exactly what he has done. Mm-hmm. You know, if you know Matt and you're close to him, you know what he's all about, you know what he is, and you know that's going to be successful over the long haul. And are you going to have seasons where it doesn't go perfectly? I mean, that year that Iowa State went 4-8, I think they were 1-7 in games decided by one score. So they're in every game. They outgained their opponents by over 100 yards a game. Mm. They actually were the only program in the Big 12 that year to outgain their opponents by over 100 yards a game, and yet they went 1-7 in the Big 12. And so it was just one of those kind of years where the ball didn't bounce your way. And it's going to happen. I mean, Iowa State's not going to just come in and out-talent everybody to the point where they can just show up and win 8 or 9 games a year. As Matt says, they kind of have to win in the margins and go up the icy side of the mountain. Those are phrases he uses, and it's not that far from the truth. They have to win their close games. They have to be really good on special teams. They have to not have a high turnover percentage. They have to win that turnover battle. They have to avoid penalties. They're first in the nation in fewest penalty yards per game. Those are the things they have to do to be successful. Now, could he go somewhere else maybe and just have more 5-star recruits and maybe things would be easier? Yeah, probably. But that's not who Matt Campbell is, you know? And I think there's a certain part of him that has this chip on his shoulder that wants to prove that he can do it at a place where it's never been done before. And that's exactly what he's doing.
Talking with the voice of the Cyclones and John Walters. And John, let me ask you something. A lot of times people will just like look at statistics, and even sometimes I do this in my game prep on Saturdays. You'll surmise, okay, the statistics mean this, but you've only seen a handful of games. But I've watched Rocco a ton. I see the 20 touchdowns and the 8 turnovers. I love the ratio, but how much of what he does is just his temperament and his personality? He seems, at least on the surface, to be an extension of his coaches.
Well, that is extremely observant of you, and I appreciate that, because I think with Rocco Beck, you grab a stat sheet after the game and you look at his numbers and you go, yeah, he was pretty good. But if you watch the game, you saw him making big throws and big moments and escaping pressure and bouncing back after negative plays, which is something he does incredibly well. He's thrown, I think, 7 pick sixes in his career. And I need to go back and look this up, because I think it would be a great stat to look up. But I would love to see what he's done on the drive after the pick sixes. Mm. But because it feels like every time that happens to him, he comes right back the next series, leads the team down the field and scores. And he just has an ability, a unique ability, to compartmentalize things. Kind of like a closer in baseball who you say, hey, go take the ball again the next day. I know you gave up a walk-off home run yesterday, but I need you to take the ball again tomorrow. And they do, and go out and have success. And I think a part of that is a product of his dad. Anthony was a great player at West Virginia. Yeah, great player at West Virginia, and then in the NFL for 11 years. And his mom was a gymnast. And so he's got this family of athletes that he can kind of draw on to understand that it's going to be a bumpy road, especially as a quarterback. It's going to be a bumpy road. It's not going to all be, you know, sunshine and rainbows. And so you're going to have to respond to adversity. And he does that better than any quarterback I've seen. And so I think the thing with Rock was, he's probably not going to be a first team all Big 12 player, or maybe not even a second team all Big 12 player, because some other guys will have more gaudy stats. But in the moment, when you need a guy to make a play, I'm not trading him for anybody.
Yeah.
And he's led 4 scoring drives at the end of games this year that have resulted in touchdowns to put Iowa State ahead. And 3 of those occasions, it was the game-winning drive. The other one, the defense didn't hold up at the end of the deal, and Texas Tech went down and scored. He also had a 2-minute drive at the end of the game last week against Kansas State at halftime to get Iowa State up by 10. But in those moments, he makes really big plays, and he's just a sophomore. And, you know, and the guys in that huddle really respect him and rally around him. So I really appreciate your question, because I think more people need to just watch the games before drawing conclusions, instead of just looking at the stats and saying, okay, here's who he is. He's a guy you gain an appreciation for by watching him play.
That's John Walters, voice of Iowa State. John, we appreciate the time as always. Enjoy the game this weekend.
Thanks, John.
All right. Thanks, guys. Appreciate it.
More Hurrdat Sports Radio coming up next. Welcome back, Hurrdat Sports Radio, kicking off hour number two here on AM 590, ESPN Omaha, ESPN Tri-Cities. That's DB. I'm Ravi Lulla, and reminding you, if you're out on the road, I know there's a lot going on in the college football world, but stay focused while you're driving, eyes straight ahead. As the driver, you've got one job to do, that is to drive. This message from the NDOT Highway Safety Office. I believe we have a caller on the line before we jump back into things.
We have Jack.
Full disclosure, we can't see.
Jack, what's going on, man? Jack, what's up?
Hey, guys. Good morning.
Golden voice, what's up?
Well, I tell you, I hate saying this, but I'm still irked over the Iowa game. I usually try to go by the 24-hour rule, but I'm having a hard time getting over this one. I tell you why. I get tired of people saying the best team lost. The best team did not lose. The best team won. We had the best players. They had the best team.
Yeah.
That's the way I look at it. Because I hopefully we'll get over that hump someday. My question to you, though, is do you think, I've heard several people report that there was a, and I don't know what they know and they don't know, because I don't know any of it, but there was a certain amount of tension rose after Snow came in to evaluate for a couple of weeks, and that maybe White didn't like having somebody looking over his shoulder, which, you know, if you look at Illinois, Northern Illinois, and UCLA, maybe somebody did need to look at it.
Jack, I want to put that to rest because.
Yeah, what do you think?
That's not true, and I think Tony White would say that.
But you've heard that too. You've heard that.
Yeah,
too,
I'm not exactly sure where that came from. The players would tell you that. I think Coach White. I know Coach White would tell you that. And it doesn't. It's not like he has to save face, because I would know, right? So he's not. He's got no reason to be disingenuous. That the Snow thing is unequivocally not true.
Good. That's good to know. That's good to know, because I didn't. I'm just telling you what you're reading, what you hear other media people say. You know.
Yeah, so I get it. And maybe I have differing opinions of them, but. I don't know how many of those guys actually go to the source, but I wouldn't say that if I didn't ask the question directly.
You know, and as far as him leaving, I really don't blame him in a way, because you go to some place like Florida State where you can throw a rock off your back deck and hit 4 stars.
Yeah.
And he's going to be able to, his scheme is going to fit really well there because of the talent in that country. And, I just hope that, and I'm sure, and I don't know the guys that are going into the portal that were starters last year. I don't know if they're going to end up down there or not. Don't know what's going on there. But, hopefully guys like Shavers and McGahee and that group of those Florida guys can stick. I hope they stay. But we'll see what happens next. And then another real quickie. I would like to see if what Jim Leonard's doing these days. I think he's an analyst for the Broncos. I mean, that guy was a heck of a defensive coordinator and did it all with a bunch of little 3 stars and little guys from the Midwest that weren't overly talented. And I'm just curious about that.
Yeah,
I'll listen to you, and thanks so much.
I appreciate it. That name's going to come up.
Yeah, as it should.
That name's going to come up.
He's the best guy out there.
So I think, you know, there's a couple things at play here. Number one, more players will leave. Mm-hmm. You'll hear about it in the next handful of days. Some will be extremely recognizable. Now, having said that, as that defense will look completely different next year.
Mm-hmm.
Zero question about it.
So Nebraska is in a point where I think they've got to decide, and I don't really know what they're going to do philosophically.
Sure.
But you've got a defensive coordinator skill set currently on staff. You could have multiple.
Mm-hmm.
Now, typically, Coach Rule likes for having coordinator experience. Like sometimes he'll even send you away to go get some tutelage.
And then come back.
Yeah. But his track record is he's always going to be good defensively.
Mm-hmm.
Like that's not an opinion. It's just
no, that's a fact.
Yeah.
That's a fact.
So I think you can trust him with whatever he decides to do on the defensive side of the ball. The only thing he doesn't really know is secondary.
Yeah.
He's very good with D-line. He's very good with linebacking play. Secondary is not really his strong suit, but is big, but can more than hold his own.
Mm-hmm.
So he has to kind of feel that out too.
That's part of the reason losing Cooper was such a big deal.
Yeah. So, I mean, that's monumental.
Yeah. The trust that he had in him to be – to not only kind of be his voice in the secondary and to be a voice in that group that he knows the least.
And you know what? Like, you know what we undersell? We act like like these real things don't happen. Like bosses and CEOs and men and women that run companies always have – folks that they trust, because mm-hmm. they'll ask those people things sometimes that they wouldn't want other people to know that they're actually asking.
Sure. Yeah.
You have
a little circle of trust.
Well, we act like, and it's so disingenuous when we want to like be mad or like the fake outrage. Like we're going to panic this week.
Yeah.
I mean, full-fledged panic. And I'm just telling you, that is okay. But I'll say that as much as I believe in my heart of hearts, it's going to be okay.
Mm-hmm.
And trust me, if anybody has any reason to be skeptical, it would be me, not you.
Sure.
Right?
Yeah.
I mean, true skin in the game.
Yeah.
So having said that, sometimes we think like coaches and like I'm sure Bill, right? Mm-hmm. Super smart, super successful. Like there are things that he will say to people that are in his tree of trust where you're like, if we were to just hear that, we'd be like, really? Like, you don't know that? Or you didn't think of that? Or you didn't? Like, those kinds of things happen.
Mm-hmm.
I worked for and am very good friends with one of the most successful people in the country, not just in Omaha, in Jay Noddle.
Mm-hmm.
Jay will say some things where I'm like, wow, because of your security in who you are, it allows you to say some of those things out loud. And you see, he simply says, you know, I don't know the answer to that question yet, whether it's rail cars or development or like, I think sometimes we just assume that those people have all the answers all the time.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes you need people that you can say things to and make yourself vulnerable. Because it's the vulnerability that we're not good at that really gives you perspective to make good decisions. When you're insecure and you pretend to know everything, 99% of the time, you're not going to make good decisions.
Yeah.
But it's not in our nature as men to be like, oh, man, who can I confide in to let them know where I'm weak?
Yeah.
It's just not what we do. So don't undersell the Coop thing.
Mm-hmm.
And Coop had his own foibles. That's neither here nor there.
But he's a tree of trust guy.
Yeah.
Right.
Right?
It's a guy that Rule would ask those questions of.
100%.
Or have those conversations with.
100%.
And losing that is probably more valuable. Because we talked about the talent eval, right? It was like, oh, man, he was kind of his ace talent evaluator for Coach Rule.
You want full, like, I'm glad you brought that up.
Yeah.
Not to interrupt, but I apologize.
No, go ahead.
If Nebraska, and I just was talking to this with my buddy yesterday, and he used to play at Nebraska, long NFL career, and he said something that I believe to be true. Coop was his number one talent evaluator guy.
I would agree.
We know that.
Yeah.
So this particular individual, his thought process was, and we're just talking about job situations and what to do in the future. If Nebraska tightens up the analyst, like the back end of the evals and doing the grunt work and just go hire like coaches, mm-hmm. they'll be just fine. So you got two options. And these are his words, not mine.
Okay.
So I don't want to steal. And so we're talking and he says, you know, this thing's going to get fixed one of two ways. You either hire elite level coaches that are proven, or you continue to do your thing as a coach developer and have guys plug the holes behind the scenes as analysts that help you have like real boots on the ground.
Mm.
And I'm listening to him, and I got another call. I shouldn't have even cut him off, but it was just like, I'm totally on board. Like, I think that. I think that.
You think either one of those works?
Either one of those could work. Either one of those could work.
I think.
Because the training system is in place.
Sure.
The strength and conditioning is good. The nutrition, fantastic. Mm-hmm. Now you have to decide, do you want to rely as much on measurables
as they have
and more on development, or do you want to hire the proven guys to coach you up and we'll do the rest? Like, that's kind of where they are, in my opinion. I thought it was a fantastic point.
So I would feel really hesitant about doing it the second way, the hiring young guys, developing them, and filling the holes on the back end. I would feel really hesitant about that because I feel like we kind of saw that a little bit with Garrett McGuire. And I don't want to pick on him, but he was the guy that seemed like Coach Rule wanted to develop and to help him with his coaching career. And they hired some people on the back end, whether it was Mosey and Holgerson ends up helping out in that room as well. And it didn't really feel like it worked. I think sometimes when you've got the inexperienced guys in the main role, you're putting yourself in a position where the players are only going to listen to the analyst, and it kind of undermines the actual assistant coach.
Well, so that matters. That is dependent on, like, the infrastructure.
Sure.
Like, if everybody understands the pecking order and the hierarchy, there isn't any guesswork. So that's the part you have to tighten up. If you're going to go the behind-the-scenes route, your roles have to be well-defined.
Yeah.
Right, because then it eliminates the communication as you run things up the flagpole.
Yeah, I just think it can open yourself up to.
I almost said totem pole. Can you say totem pole?
Yeah, totem poles are a thing that, I mean.
I know, but the whole Seminole thing, I just was like.
Typically, totem poles actually exist in the northern tribes, like in Canada and stuff, but that's okay. What?
Are you Vasco da Gama or somebody? Like, what do you know?
I read sometimes. Learn some things
because history books are so accurate. We still celebrate Columbus Day.
Not everybody.
No, you're exactly right.
I do think there's a challenge there, and frankly, from a fan base standpoint, I think the fan base would have a really hard time with that second scenario as well.
Yeah,
I think people want you to go out and hire experienced assistant coaches, guys that have a track record. Guys like Dana Holgerson, where they can point to and go, I know what that guy can do. I know what he's done. That's a guy that I like. A guy like Jim Leonard, where they go, hey, I know what that guy's done. I know what he can do. That's a guy we can hire. Because I think part of the issue with Nebraska fans is they know the money's there, right? They know you've got the budget to go out and pay top dollar for assistance. And if you can pay top dollar for assistance, you're probably going to get top assistance.
Mm.
You may not get your first choice, but you're going to have a pretty good pool of candidates to pull from, right? If you're paying $1.5 million for coordinators, Tony White was making 1.6, right? If you're paying that for coordinators, you're probably going to get really good coordinators. If you're paying top dollar for assistants and position coaches, you're probably going to get top-level positions and assistant coaches. I think that's where Nebraska fans get frustrated, because even if it's a philosophical thing, not a money thing, it feels to them like Nebraska's being cheap. And that's a thing that Nebraska fans really, really struggle with. And I don't blame them, especially when the developing coaches thing doesn't feel like it's working. it's really hard to be like, well, just spend the money. If we have a fix, right, we can spend the money and fix it. Why don't we just spend the money and fix it?
Yeah, I don't think it's a monetary issue.
I don't either.
You're paying Holgorsen 1.2. You got it for two. I think they like the language in there that gives you some assurances, same as they did Tony White's contract.
Yep.
That gives you some assurances, which Coach White was well aware of.
Yeah.
Which the University of Nebraska was well aware of. I think you pay Coach Knighton.
Yeah, absolutely.
You are figuring out what you want to do on the offensive side of the ball.
But unless Coach Holgorsen is going to be the wide receivers coach, go pay somebody.
No, and they will.
You know?
They will.
Like, go pay somebody. They go will. Go they pay somebody to fix special teams.
I feel pretty good about that.
Go pay somebody. Like, if you've got issues, use the money.
Yeah.
What are you saving it for? Like, it's not a rainy day fund when it's raining and you refuse to use the money.
I think they're going to be okay there.
Yeah.
They do. So you're going to have a little more fallout with I think you're going to have to finish out with the portal deal.
Yeah.
Like, filter through that.
Which we haven't even got to the guys that have hopped in yet, but.
Yeah, so where are we at so far? So we're at Bear, Butler.
Irvin. Thompson. Vincent Jackson.
Okay.
And then, yeah, the guys that hopped in early, like Malachi Coleman and then Sincere way back in the fall.
Yeah.
But as far as new guys, those are the five that we're at so far.
Give them to me one more time.
Gabe Irvin, Makai Bear.
Fell out of playing time.
Okay. Yep. Makai Bear.
Grad.
And I think he got passed. Grad. Personally.
But grad.
Jamari Butler.
Went in last year. Could come back. We'll see.
Yeah. Stephon Thompson.
Wasn't going to play. That was the Coach White guy.
Vincent Jackson.
Yeah, the guy that retweeted something that he shouldn't have retweeted.
Yeah. None of those guys strike me as...
Who was coming off a disciplinary deal.
Mm-hmm.
Disappeared for a couple games.
Yep.
Okay.
None of those guys strike me as the sky's falling. Jamari Butler's the closest.
Yeah, big JB guy because JB is a Coach Rule guy.
Mm-hmm.
But Coach Rule has to decide. That's one of those. This is what I love about him.
Mm-hmm.
That's one of those where Coach Rule has to decide, do I do what's best for me or is there something different in terms of what's best for him?
Like a Chief Border situation.
Because I know what he told me in Indianapolis.
Yeah.
He's like, if Jamari Butler can go make some money, it's going to be hard. I'm hard-pressed to say, don't go make money.
Mm-hmm.
But I do want him with us.
Yeah.
And he said that in Indianapolis.
Yeah. Back in July.
So.
And Jamari had a solid year.
He was hurt a good chunk of the time.
He can be disruptive.
We only saw flashes of JB. I like JB because that dude lays it on the line.
Yeah.
But he's an easy guy to cheer for. So it doesn't matter where I'm cheering for him.
Mm-hmm.
You'll
root for him.
I root for him.
But that's a guy that
good dude.
Could be disruptive when healthy, kind of is a Coach Rule guy. That's the only one that I look at and even bat my eyes at all. I think Bayer got passed.
Yeah.
Or was going.
No.
Or was going to be passed by next year.
I would entertain that.
I know he started 11 games, but look at the rotation.
I would entertain that.
Look who's playing.
I don't think that's speculation.
I think there was going to be a playing time crunch for Bayer next year. Yeah. That one makes sense to me. Stephon Thompson makes sense to me. Vincent Jackson makes sense for the issues brought up. Gabe Irvin makes sense. The one that I'm like, might be nice to have him there would be Jamari Butler. But you've got a lot of guys that play that position too, and a lot of young guys that play that position.
And some of the guys you may hear coming out or, you know, that may be portal candidates, some of it is just wear and tear.
Mm. How so?
It could be physical. It could be emotional. Been a lot.
Just mentally?
Yeah, I just want a clean slate.
Yeah.
And while you're getting a clean break, you might as well get a clean break.
Yeah. Yeah, it's fair. Just been emotionally and mentally been through a lot the last couple of years.
Yeah. A couple of guys, I think you'll hear a lot of it is physical.
Yeah.
So.
I mean, Gabe Irvin's a guy that's been banged up a lot.
Yeah, just the emotional toll it's taken, too. I tell you, rehab's a lonely place. Then when you watch other people doing your job, it's hard. It's hard.
two comments here on the YouTube page. I can't read that, so I'm going to say Carmina.
Okay.
I literally am seeing blurry.
Yeah, I
is it K-A-R?
Yeah, it looks like it, yeah.
Okay. He says, I'd love to hear Damon's thoughts on Butler. He came in with such high pedigree, but results are underwhelming. Was it a scheme in place, talent, sending back, working with college athletes? Wow, that's a good one. I like Butler.
Yeah.
I like Butler a lot. So there's three things. Number one, I think Coach Butler, and he'll self-admittedly will tell you, I need to reinvest in talking to young people. I'm looking forward to this offseason so I can get to know the guys again on a personal level and better help that way. His son was on the flight this week. He sat right behind me, Manny. I don't want to not like spilling tea, but I like Butler. Now, I have said this for about 6 weeks. I just had this conversation with Coach Queen, our co-defensive coordinator, and one of our other coaches. And I think we undersell, and I've been saying this, so this isn't like current. I think we undersell marrying coverage to run fits.
Yeah.
It takes some time.
You talked a lot about that with Ohio State, too.
I even put it on social media. Mm-hmm. But that doesn't mean there's conflict. And I just talked to Joel, so he texted me to let me know where the whole conflict was with Coach White. But I'm going to venture to guess that I don't know. I don't know if the two aforementioned would have talked to Coach White, mm-hmm. or they're getting that second or third hand. I'll ask those guys after the show. But so there is a learning process, right? You changed a couple of the guys' roles.
Mm-hmm.
You come in with a fresh set of eyes. You're going to ask Giff to do some things differently. Hey, I think he has a few limitations. I'm going to keep him a little more deep hole. Coach White may say, hey, I really need him as another run fitter. Coach Butler may say, hey, you know, Singleton is a guy that is a little more athletic, a little twitchy, can get down in the box. Coach White may say, now this is, I swear to goodness, I shouldn't even use this because this is my opinion.
Yeah.
This is my opinion.
How you're watching the guys.
This is how I would have flip-flopped their roles.
Yeah.
Right? That's me. I would have flip-flopped their roles. I don't think Deshaun is interested in tackling. And I think Giff needs to be closer to the box. But from a communication standpoint, I know why they did what they did. So what you try to do is you try to just get by.
Yeah.
So you're trying to marry the coverages. And then all of a sudden you get balls thrown over your head because
– and miscommunications result in touchdowns.
Yeah, and miscommunication is also because guys' roles have changed slightly. So the low-hanging fruit – Cam, can I just call him? No, I don't want to say it's not Cam. It's Carm. Can I just say Carm?
Carm.
Karma?
Just
call him Karma?
Yeah.
The low-hanging fruit would be, oh, man, you know, the whole cook. We get the whole cooks in the kitchen analogy. The real thing is you have to – it takes time.
Butler got here in August – or in July.
It takes time.
Uh-huh.
So, they had some learning to do. I like Butler, though. I like Butler.
My biggest question with Butler is if they bring in an outside DC, is he going to be okay?
So you know that. You sound like my wife. Why overthink it? You don't think they'll have thought about that?
No, I'm sure they will have.
Okay, so.
But I'm also thinking about it.
Yeah, but that's not a concern. Like, if it's going to be an issue,
yeah.
they wouldn't do it.
Or maybe they're willing to let it be an issue and do it anyway. That's an option.
Yeah, I'll entertain that.
Like, that's what I mean. Like, is it. Yeah, going to be an issue, they have to deal with it.
That would be unnecessary fretting. And I hate telling you how you should think because it's how I would think.
Yeah.
And I know people accuse us of thinking too much alike. But, why work yourself up into that?
I don't know that I'm worked up. I'm just thinking about what are the dominoes.
Then he can go.
Yeah.
And that's how you got to look at it.
But then you got to find a new secondary coach.
There's a lot more in there. I got one more question because I like Connor's question too.
We'll get to Connor's question and more coming up next here on Hurrdat Sports Radio. We're back here on Hurrdat Sports Radio, AM 590, ESPN Omaha, ESPN Tri-Cities. That's DB. I'm Ravi Lulla. We're brought to you by our friends at Folding Warehouse Omaha. It's just like bowling, but instead of a ball, you're throwing a football. It's a ton of fun. DB and I went over there a couple weeks ago, had a grand old time. It is a great place for friends, for family, for big business parties. They've got the whole thing covered. It's a huge space. They've got two full-service bars, and you can bring in your own food. It's a great place to hang out, whether for business, for pleasure, whatever it is. Make sure you get to FullingOmaha.com to check out their holiday hours and to reserve a lane. DB,
what up?
We had another YouTuber with a question.
Yeah, was that Connor? Are we getting back to Connor?
Yeah, let's get back to Connor.
Yeah, so Connor said, I lost it. I went back up to Carmina's. Where's Connor? Where's Connor?
Further up on the...
Okay, want your guys' take on this. Dannon talks very proudly about being in the black financially.
Mm-hmm.
But many businessmen have said they operate in the red because you need to spend money to make money. So, I don't know. Like, the dirty little secret is numbers lie.
Yeah, you can kind of make them.
So, I wouldn't be caught up in the whole black-red thing. But what I would say is, Connor, is I think Dannon will do whatever it takes in the short term to get this program right. He knows that the average shelf life for an AD is 4 to 5 years, and he's going to try to make hay.
Yeah.
Like, I feel safe.
I also think he probably understands that, hey, if this football program doesn't get going, everybody loses their job, so it doesn't really matter. Right?
Yeah.
Like, everybody, if Nebraska football doesn't win, everybody gets fired again.
Yeah.
That's how it works. Right? We've seen it over and over and over again.
I just think, you know, you'll figure out what you want to do. You'll figure out what you want to do with the rest of your staff
mm-hmm.
on the offensive side. You'll decide whether you want to go get another new DC, bring in a familiar DB's coach and make Butler a DC, see if Butler's cool with not being a DC.
Yeah.
If Butler isn't cool with not being a DC and you want to bring in a DC, do you get rid of Butler? But at the end of the day, you have signing day in 24 hours.
Yeah.
So you got to get that done.
Yes.
Okay, so I do think that there are players that are familiar or in the know with what Nebraska's plans are.
I would agree. I think that includes some recruits.
Yeah, I would be in agreement.
We saw yesterday, and it's not, I mean, we're speculating what they meant, but we saw yesterday all at about the same time, a bunch of guys, Tyson Terry, Caden Vermaas, Pierce Mooberry, Christian Jones, Dawson Merritt, all tweet out some sort of pro-Nebraska
yeah.
sentiments,
yeah.
whether it's gifts, whether it's, you know, Christian Jones and Dawson Merritt affirming their...
That's why they group recruit.
Mm-hmm.
That's why they recruit in masses.
Yeah. Well, it right. helps insulate against it this. Being about one guy.
Yeah.
Right? Dawson Merritt's dad tweeted out, hey, don't worry about one man's moves when, you know, you got God's got plans for you or what to paraphrase. Right.
Yeah, yeah.
But that's the key to recruiting this way is if a guy leaves, you are not up a creek.
Yeah. And the beauty about growth is like we can like I can still love you and we're not on the same page. Right. Like I talk to Joel all the time, mm-hmm. all the time. And so this is hard for me. Because I'm a huge Tony White guy.
Yeah.
I cheer for you as a person. As a person. Not somebody that I work with for the network. Not somebody that was like on the ground level seeing you all those times in my high school or in my house. Like, I cheer for you as a person.
Mm-hmm.
So to hear like it bottom lined... I know he doesn't mean bottom lining it, but because he says, hey, listen, you know, like, I know this is too simplistic. It lacks context. But Nebraska is 11-13 with White as a DC. Objectively, there needs to be an overhaul in one way or another, and I choose to see this as an opportunity. Even got, you know, so there's Joel, guys that I'm close to, Severe. Like, I know how they feel,
mm-hmm.
and I have to be able to process the information and still have objective conversations without it altering my mood because personally I know how I feel.
Yeah.
Right? Not wrong. Statistically, this was not really a top 20 scoring defense.
Mm-hmm.
But I also think he's a really, really good defensive mind. I can also say that even though I love him as a person, and I think he's a tremendous coach, I still love my university more.
Sure.
Right? And I trust Coach Rule more than I love Tony White.
Say that again.
I trust Coach Rule more than I love Tony White.
And you care about the university more than either.
Yes.
So that's the pecking order.
Yes.
And that's why it's important. It's important to know that, not only for you.
Well, you can understand the words that are coming out of my mouth.
Yes, as we process the things you say, right? University first.
Yep.
Whatever's best for the university.
Yep.
Number one with a bullet.
Yep.
Number two, you trust what Matt Rule is doing.
Yep.
Number three.
Then my like for any other individual people.
Yes, whether it's Tony White.
That's not family.
Right. Yeah, yeah. But in terms of the university, right?
Yeah.
Where it's love for Tony White, love for T. Knighton.
I understand statistically, you can't rank 50th and 84th and yards per attempt and yards per complete. I understand there were some drop-offs.
Yeah.
Right?
But and you saw it. You could see it.
Yeah, but I also understand. This is hard. I'm just going to say it. When you go with things that you trust, because you play the short-term game,
mm-hmm.
You make yourself vulnerable to those kinds of statistics.
The short-term, you mean in a game?
In a game.
Right?
In a game.
Because I think some people hear short-term and they're like, this season, right? But short-term, you're like, hey, these guys give me the best opportunity today.
Today.
And long-term, that can bite
you.
Now,
I don't have to agree with that. But I
with the philosophy?
No, but I can tell you what I think happens. I do it.
It can get on top of you in a hurry.
I do it.
If that's how you're operating, that gets on top of you in a hurry.
I do it.
And then it's really hard to go back.
I'll give you a prime example.
Because now you don't have the time.
There are times I want to play Andrew Taggy.
Mm-hmm.
Going to be a great player. Just a pup.
Yep.
And then somebody inevitably will say, hey, are you sure we want to go young in this spot at this juncture? And I'll get talked off of it.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's a really good example. It's
like that happens.
Yeah.
Like that's a
don't get talked off of it, DB.
I could, but it, so here's the thing.
Yeah.
Excuse me. In the meantime,
yeah,
we're winning.
Yeah. You are. They're not.
So I get it, man.
That's like, the difference, right?
There are so many examples. Just like the whole job thing. Like when I tell you about. You know, there's clearly times where I feel like I'm struggling and I'm like, oh man, I could be doing X, Y, and Z. But then I'm like, oh my God, I'd never see my kids.
Yeah.
But you're winning.
Right? So I know what sustains me. I do.
Yeah, you got to know, again, when you're making decisions, you got to know the priorities, right?
It's
family.
It's a conflict.
Yeah.
So when I'm watching this unfold and I look at Nebraska statistically and I see what they're trying to do, even if I have skin in the game,
mm-hmm.
I'm like, oh, my God, this kid right here. I just listened to two former players yesterday, one I talked to forever. He's like, man, listen, I watched this dude practice. Let that dude go miss a tackle. At least it'll matter to him.
Yeah.
I'm like, oh, yeah, no, believe me, I agree. But.
You brought up yesterday with Nair when he missed the catch. Didn't look like it really mattered to him.
I'll never forget that. And I feel petty. I do. Like, openly, like, I can tell you. I was talking to Joel and I said, you know what, Joel, like I'm so mad. Like I couldn't sleep. But then I felt guilty for it bothering me. I was livid because what was happening at the same time? All the fake outrage mm-hmm. about stupid handshakes and pregame rituals.
Yep.
I'm like, this might be the dumbest thing I've ever heard.
Especially when there's something on the field in front of all of our eyes that might actually matter.
That you could actually control.
That might actually matter.
I was mad. And I, listen, I'm not mad at Higgins. To the victor goes the spoils. He can say whatever he wants to, and he can control the narrative, and Iowa fans can pile on. But it just pisses me off that we have things that were in our control that you could actually do that help affect outcomes,
mm-hmm.
and we goddamn didn't do it.
Yeah.
So believe me, I hear it. I hear it. The bloodletting is not done, but I'm just telling you, I trust the heck out of Coach Rule because I think there's a plan. And there's a couple things he's really good at. One thing he's really, really good at He'll get the defensive side of the ball right. This dude will always play good defense.
Yeah.
And I can also, in the same vein, say, you know what, man? Coach White, I know why you did what you did. Because I think I do.
And his rules hirings on the defensive side of the ball have always been on point. I will say, when you're trying to get to 6-6 versus you guys on a 32-game win streak, playing for today makes a little bit more sense in one of those situations than the
other.
Knock
it off.
We got more Hurrdat Sports Radio coming up next. Wrapping up hour number two here on Hurrdat Sports Radio, AM 590, ESPN Omaha, ESPN Tri-Cities. That's DB. I'm Ravi Lulla here on the Pillar exterior stage. We are joined now by Mike Gross. He covers Penn State for Lancaster Online. Mike, how are you this morning?
I'm great. How you guys doing?
You've got to be great, Mike. I love the fact you said great. Like, it's got to be good to be a Nittany Lion. Are you tired, or do you even get the question? Because sometimes I think this, and I watch you guys every week. I'm like, wait a second. How are they doing it? They just keep winning. Like, do you think that, or you just for the ride? Because all you guys do is rack up W's.
Well, first of all, I'm a little uncomfortable with you referring to me as you guys. Like, I'm part of the team.
I get really accused not. Of that, but in my defense, I do work for the radio network, so it's fine. Okay, I'll take
it. but the short answer is yes, I am surprised because I don't think, you know, they don't have an elite win, certainly, and I don't think they've really had a great four-quarter performance. But they have been really good at doing winning things at the end of games. They have been legitimate at that, and maybe that's what it takes in this era with this 12-team playoff. If they find a way to beat Oregon, they might be the number one seed in the whole deal. So it's pretty remarkable. They have had a great year. I don't think there's any question about that. And even if they lose to Oregon, and it's a competitive game, they got a good shot to be in that 5-seed spot, which I think is pretty favorable. That's a good place to be, given the format of this tournament. So that's a long way of saying yes, I am surprised.
Blessing or a curse that there's some wiggle room that you're in regardless.
Blessing or a curse that you're
that Penn State is in regardless. Game? Yeah, that Penn State is in the playoffs regardless.
That's a good question because you know motivation is so much of this. You're trying to take this sort of psychological temperature of these teams. Penn State, I think, is sort of past that. That was a real question coming off of the Ohio State game and those couple of weeks. I think they're sort of past that, and you know James Franklin constantly has this mantra of 1-0 this week. I think they believe it. I think they actually believe that stuff, and they have done a really good job of showing up every week. I credit them for that.
So like, what do you mean up? You play one week at a time?
That's crazy talk.
Mike, if you're the coach of one of these teams, would you rather be heading into the playoff as Penn State 11-1 playing in the Big Ten championship game or Indiana 11-1? You're likely in both scenarios, but you don't have to worry about playing Oregon. You don't have to worry about the wear and tear or coming off a loss. Like which of those positions would you rather be in?
Well, I would, if I was going that Penn State is probably going to have, I'll be brutally honest with you. If I was James Franklin and you injected me with truth serum, I'd rather not be playing on Saturday.
That's kind of what I thought, right?
If I was going to get, now Indiana's not going to get as good a seed as Penn State would have gotten had Ohio State beat Michigan, and they wouldn't be playing. And you know what I'm saying?
Right.
And Penn State would not be playing on Saturday. Mm. That would be preferable in terms of making a run in the playoff, but not by a lot. I mean, this is just the grind of it and how many games you have to play. You know, Penn State had two byes this year. One of them was sort of early. I'm not sure how much good that did them, but brutally honest, I think a lot of the coaches think this. Lane Kiffin said it a couple weeks ago. I'm not sure it's a good idea to be in this conference championship game. Then his team went out and laid an egg that week, so it became a little bit of a moot point for them. But I think I would rather not have this hurdle in the way.
So, Mike, at what point does Coach Franklin win enough where Ohio State and Michigan don't become conversations? Because he sure does win. He sure does win a lot.
Yeah, he does. He really does. You know, it's honestly, we'll see how that plays out over the next few years, given the new normal of this sport, because they don't have divisions anymore. They're not going to play. The Big Ten doesn't have divisions anymore. They're not going to play Ohio State, Michigan every year. They didn't play Michigan this year. It's just going to be a much different animal because you have great variety of strength of schedule and strength of schedule within conferences. You know, this absurd thing where Indiana and Oregon and Penn State, you know, didn't play each other. And they were all kind of vying for the conference championship. And Ohio State was really the only contender there that played all the others. It's weird. But I think that's going to change the calculus a little bit. But you know what? With a 12-team playoff, if he gets bounced in the first round, the critics are going to be going nuts again. I mean, that's not going to change.
Yeah, Mike, as you look at this Penn State team and kind of the way they're constructed, how they've performed throughout the year, where would your concern be about their ability to make a run in the college football playoff?
I think their defense is good enough to keep them in game. So that's not it. I think their defense will be able to compete with even the best teams in the country. Their offense, they have not been consistent running the ball. When I say running the ball, I mean just straightforward. It's first and 10 in the 30-yard line, and you hand the ball to the running back. And now I will say Nick Singleton looked healthy for the first time maybe all year last Saturday against Maryland. And when he's 100%, he is crazy athletic and fast and explosive and powerful, and he might be a difference maker. But the other thing is they don't have a great group of wide receivers, so they don't get to stretch the field very much by throwing it to these sort of very conventional ways that teams move the ball and score points in football. They're not great at. The wild card is Tyler Warren, the tight end, who is such a unique piece, and they use him in so creatively in so many different ways. Andy Kotelnicki, the first year offensive coordinator for Penn State, who now in the last couple of days, he's already being talked about for the West Virginia job, I noticed. But anyway, he's done a magnificent job of kind of tap dancing as he can with pre-snap stuff and deception, and with using this unique weapon he has that has become like his favorite toy in Tyler Warren.
So, if this is the case with Warren, you know, as a coordinator, I'd say to myself, okay, find 44, figure out where he is pre-snap. This is what we want to do. Why is it so hard to neutralize him when you know that 60% of the time he's going to be involved in a play?
Well, a little, it's like watching Jason Kelce a little bit, isn't it? How is that dude open all the time?
Good point.
Yeah, it's a little bit like that, but I think you kind of answered your question a little bit. It's the fact that they move him around. If you have a guy like Marvin Harrison Jr., I mean, you know that he's going to be a wide receiver. He's a tremendous wide receiver, but it's going to be a coverage issue. And what are we going to do in the back end? And who is going to match up with him? Are we going to play man or zone or any of that stuff? That's the problem with Marvin Harrison, and I'm not saying it's a big problem. It's a small problem. It's a huge problem. But with Tyler Warren, you don't have no idea where he's going to be. They direct snap it to him like a quarterback.
Yeah.
And he was a quarterback in high school. I just think it's hard to do something as a defense when you just don't know where he's going, how he's going to be used from play to play. And I think Kotelnicki is really smart about utilizing it.
Mike, last one from me here. As you kind of look at Oregon, I'm sure as you're doing your research and prep on the Ducks. What scares you about Oregon in this matchup?
I think a couple of things. One, their defensive line against Penn State's offensive line, which is a little beat up and a little bit patched together right now. That's one thing. And the other thing is, when I look at Dylan Gabriel, who I think is a terrific player, he's an Argus quarterback, of course, a transfer from Oklahoma. When I look at him, Penn State is a man coverage team. They really base a lot of what they do defensively on press man coverage. And it seems to me that Gabriel, when he has had mediocre numbers this year, it's been against zone teams. It's been against those teams that kind of read the quarterback's eyes and everything. I'm not sure why that is, because Gabriel's tremendous at throwing on the run from what I've seen, and extending plays. And I mean, it's hard to read a guy's eyes when he's flying around like that. I think Dylan Gabriel, and then again, as I said, the matchup up front when Penn State has the ball.
That's Mike Gross from Lancaster Online. Mike, we appreciate the time as always, and enjoy the game this weekend.
Thanks, fellas. Have fun.
Thanks, Mike.
That is Mike Gross from Lancaster Online. Good stuff there. Yeah, I'm excited for some of the games this weekend, but that is obviously at the top of the hill for me.
Yeah, free Saturday. What am I going to do with myself?
I imagine you're going to watch a lot of football.
Probably.
If I had to guess.
It's a good bet.
Probably spend too much time on your cell phone talking to people about nonsense.
Not doing that at all. There's going to be some huge piece of protein that I'm going to eat, though, that's for sure.
Not tracking coaching moves?
Nope.
Not at all?
Nope. Not one bit.
Going to be real active on Twitter?
Nope.
Coming up next, we got our guy Mike Schaefer, Husker 24/7. More Hurrdat Sports Radio coming up next. Welcome back. Hurrdat Sports Radio, AM 590, ESPN Omaha, ESPN Tri-Cities, KFOR, and Lincoln. That's DB. I'm Ravi Lulla here on the Pillar Exterior Stage as we are efforting our friend Mike Schaefer from Husker 24/7.
I just talked to Schaefer. He should be around.
Well, you know, it's been a busy time, I think.
Yeah, what? Like, what's he doing? Working?
I don't know. You know, probably not hanging out at Lawrence and Gardens like we were.
It's not like tonight is or tomorrow's recruiting day.
No, he doesn't have anything going on.
No, we weren't. So I was surprised we both got there at the exact same time early.
Yeah, we were early.
That was weird.
That was good on us. Look at us being adults.
Were you trying to avoid traffic?
No. That's just when I left.
Well, I was trying to avoid traffic. And I also thought the sooner I got there, the sooner we could get done because I still had to make dinner for the kids.
That's true. We did get in and out pretty quick.
Although, by the time I got home, Mike had made Zoe warmed up 3 pieces of Paisan's cheese pizza, and he let her eat them all.
She ate 3 pieces of pizza?
Of that giant pizza that he has. I'm like, oh, you must have cut off the crust. She said, no, I ate the crust. It's like, oh, my God.
The kid's going to just housing away that pizza, man.
I can't stand her.
We got Mike here.
Let's join our friend here, Mike Schaefer, Husker 24/7. What's up, Schaefer?
Hey, guys. How we doing?
Mike J.
You busy?
You busy?
Just just a little bit. I didn't know what to think of everything being moved up and kind of crammed into that space right behind the end of the regular season. And if I learned anything on Monday, it said I'm going to definitely ask for that week off next year and just be somewhere tropical. Because that was wild. I feel like I'm not a therapist, and yet yesterday I had to be a therapist and a psychologist and a recruiting writer.
Oh man.
And I don't know what there's a lot of hats.
Yeah.
I own a lot of hats, but I had to use all of them yesterday.
Man.
And that was
Dave, I finally had to shut it down. Like I just
Oh, you get the luxury of shutting it down? When you're called 24/7, you don't have that luxury.
Hey, I had to make a mental health decision.
Yeah, I get it.
At one point yesterday, and bless my heart for not falling victim, I have a brand new thing at Tequila. I had a coupon for $40 off if you spend X amount of money. And I went out in the garage and I looked at it and I'm like, could I pull a Bugs Bunny, dive, and fit through the opening in that bottle? And I decided, nope, couldn't do it. I better go parent. So I went back in the house. But I did contemplate seeing if I could just, like, springboard and get inside. Because I
was it the years of physics that let you know that was not going to be possible? Or?
I mean, I'll try anything once.
That they went. Fair enough.
I did think of you last night for more than one reason. As they panned the audience in the Broncos deal as Jameis Winston was cashing at the window because he bet on Denver. A lot of Coors bottles, and I'm like, you know what? That's a Mike J. Schaefer thing.
Yeah, no, it's believe it or not, the Coors is quite popular in Denver.
Never heard of it.
all right, my sarcasm meter is going way up for this one.
Schaefer, as we kind of filter through some, I think we lost him.
I hope not.
Yeah, I think we lost him. The internet's being super fun today.
Yeah.
Having a good time. Having a good time.
Shane, just call him on the phone.
Yep. Thank you, Shane. If you can't see us, hopefully you can still hear us. But no, as you're going through the kind of the exercise yesterday.
He's still there. Just try to.
Oh, hi, Mike.
Shane,
can you hear us?
Can you hear us?
Hey, yeah, I can hear you guys. Your picture is frozen. You guys look delightfully happy with each other.
Yeah, I'm just laughing at you, Shane.
All I can do is just hear what's going on, but you know, we can still do this interview.
All right, cool.
Let's do this interview then, Schaefer. As you filter through the information yesterday, at what point, like, was any of it surprising to you? Let's start there.
Well, I want to be very careful in how I word this.
Why?
Very careful in how I word this, because there's stuff that happened yesterday, like. Yeah, there was some stuff that surprised me in how things were presented or reported. I guess we'll put it that way because
Listen, I've already bashed people and not in the industry, but just irresponsible media. So you can too if you want.
Well, I don't need to be a media scold because, you know, people make mistakes or things happen, whatever. But I just found it fascinating how quickly stuff was being put out that, you know, and I'm in a situation where we have guys down at Florida State who do a tremendous job covering that team and are really well tied in. And I could basically go to them and be like, hey, have you heard this? And they would be like, yeah, I mean, there's some of that out there, but here's why it's not likely to happen in the, you know, immediacy or things of that nature.
I completely agree.
And so I guess I think in the rush to add to everyone drinking from the fire hose, I was a little surprised at some of the stuff that was getting put out that, you know, there might be an element of truth to it and maybe it could happen down the road, but it certainly wasn't happening on Monday. Yeah. And I guess there's a part of me that in a society where media literacy just gets worse by the second, we have an extra responsibility to be as accurate as we possibly can. And so, you know, I get that more people have more fun talking about what could be in the speculation and the rumors than what is actually happening. But there are real people, real honest to God people whose names are associated with what reports are saying, who are also responsible for helping recruit or have position players in their room who have the internet and have no idea what the hell is going on. And we owe a better responsibility to real people with real names if we're going to put stuff out there. That's my entire.
Hey, I love the fact you prefaced that with, I'm not going to media scold. And then,
I mean, look, if you want me to scold, I can get a lot more scoldy.
Lips to God's ears, what you just said. I mean, real life things involved. And it was just like, what are we doing?
I was so
disappointed. I felt
the utter lack of context with some of it, too. It's just like, I mean, I know we want to get stuff up on the internet, but man. Like we owe it to try to be as accurate as possible. And I'm not trying to, you know, everyone's got to do their job and everyone has their information, but we all have that little radar in our brain that, you know, is this publishable? Do I have everything vetted here? I mean, I sent one text and I refuted something in 2 seconds.
Schaefer, just so we're all on the same page here, I don't want to assume everybody's as online as we all are. Are we talking about the Knighton portion of the conversation?
We're talking about Knighton. We're talking Garrett McGuire. We're talking about assistant coaches. We're, you know, like Tony White was one thing, and there was a lot of traction to that. And that started, you know, well before Monday. But I think we kind of saw things get a little ahead of the skis. And I don't know what's going to happen with Nebraska's assistant coaches. And I don't want to pretend like, you know, Terrence Knighton is definitely going to be Nebraska's defensive line coach in 2025. And Garrett McGuire is definitely going to be Nebraska's wide receivers coach. But I know as of right now, on Tuesday, December 3rd, they're working for Nebraska. And so I like, you know, and then you have signing day on December 4th. I'm just like, there is a part of me that we have a responsibility to put accurate information out there and not fan the flames. And, you know, some of yesterday I felt like I was a firefighter trying to put some stuff out that wasn't quite happening as was being discussed.
Hey, Mike J, as you're kind of looking at how tomorrow unfolds, what are the odds? Like there's the unintended consequence would be something like, well, if such and such and such and such is entering the portal or this is happening, it's actually a positive for those potential signees for tomorrow. Has that been kind of in your, on your barometer?
You know, yes and no. Like there's always, like there's the, you know, obvious sort of cliche of when one door, you know, when a door shuts, a window opens kind of thing. So I think you can view it in that sense. I sort of tend to take the view of, in the case of Jamari Butler and Mekhi Bayer, two players that I think highly of, that I think, you know, are good college players. There's also the realm of which it can be mutually beneficial for both Nebraska and for those individuals to not be together for the 2025 season. Mm. You know, they both can have good things can happen for Nebraska because opportunity will pop up for other players that those two have seeded their reps and their opportunities for. Good things can happen for them when they go somewhere else and everything can move on fine. It hurts because they're names that we know and they're players that you recognize and there's flashpoints that they've had in their career, but it doesn't mean the program has to shut down. It doesn't mean the defense is going to fall apart. It doesn't mean that Nebraska can't replace what they were able to do. It's just on the coaching staff to figure out how they're going to do that. It's on players to determine, hey, you know, Jamari's not here anymore. Maybe it's my time to be a defensive lineman at Nebraska. Maybe it's my time to be a vocal leader. Mekhi Bayer's not here. Maybe it's my time to step in as an inside linebacker. I mean, it's all about how you want to frame it. And that's life in the transfer portal. You know, when one guy leaves, another guy gets to fill that spot. It's what that guy does and how the coaching staff prepares him is ultimately what matters.
Chafe, has anybody entered the portal yet that has caused you any heartburn?
Hey,
I think Jamari Butler and Mekhi Bayer are good players. I think that they were going to be good players again in 2025. But there probably hasn't been like an all Big Ten type of person that has entered the portal. Like as much as I like Jamari Butler, we're still talking about 7.5 sacks across two seasons. We're talking about a guy who absolutely dominated in the Ohio State game, but there was times that he was unavailable because of injury or everything else. So, I mean, again, I don't want to speak ill because these guys would have played for Nebraska. I have no doubt about that. But I mean, I think sometimes we take returning numbers or returning experience and we build it up for more than what it is. I mean, how often do we do that when a player comes into the program? How lofty were our expectations for Jamal Banks and Isaiah Nayer and Billy Kemp and kind of Ainoa and all of these different wide receivers? And it's largely been Trey Palmer and Samari Toure have been the only real difference makers Nebraska's had at those positions. So I'm just saying, like, you know, the portal doesn't always mean that a player who leaves somewhere to go somewhere else or comes to Nebraska is going to be an even better version than what they were somewhere else. Sometimes they're just going to be the same guy they are somewhere where they're not.
Schaefer, what about like just the whole, excuse me, just considering how emotional the last 2 years is, do you factor in like just the emotional well-being, like just simply a fresh start? Because I think sometimes there's this tendency to make it kind of linear, right? Like playing time versus not playing time or whatever.
sometimes it's like, who is it? Is it Snicker? Like the people that just want to get away for a while? Like, what if it is just like, could be something as simple as like the Snickers thing?
I mean, yeah, there's the element of wanting a fresh start. I guess there's a part of me that you're 2 years into this build, needing a fresh start seems a little early, but maybe.
Although
you
would probably agree it's been a little overly dramatic, right?
Oh, well, in terms of yesterday or just the entirety of the 2 years?
The
entirety of basically me covering Nebraska football. I mean, I think drama and Nebraska football kind of go hand in hand. I don't know if you can divorce yourself from that.
Yeah, that's probably fair.
How about just yes?
Yeah, that's probably fair.
What do you think, Mike?
But it's like we've made this into a 365-day-a-year thing. Like, I don't know that you can just remove drama from it. Yeah. Like, it's always going to be there to some degree. There's, you know, there's like a five-week period somewhere after spring ball and somewhere before summer workouts really kind of get going full bore where you sort of forget that the football program is you know, still, you know, it's there, but they're usually not making news in that stretch of time that's bad news. So, you know, you kind of have to remember that 5 weeks versus the rest of the 47 weeks of the year, I guess.
Yeah, Schaefer, May and June are nice, aren't they?
What was that?
I said May and June are nice, aren't they?
Yeah, I mean, those May is like the best month of the year. I never would have thought that before, but now like May is fantastic. I try to, you know, try to sneak in a vacation in May. Usually don't work as many hours in May. Every other month, less so, but May's a good month.
Dave, as we kind of sit here, obviously we've talked a lot about a lot of the things that happened over the last day or so. If you were a betting man, I'm not asking you to report unsourced information or anything, but if you were a betting man, you think Nebraska goes in-house or outside hire for defensive coordinator?
I mean, if I'm guessing right now today, just based off of what I have heard through, you know, starting in the summer when John Butler was hired all the way to where we are now, I would bet on John Butler being Nebraska's next defensive coordinator, but that's because it fits the sort of puzzle that has been presented to me since July of last year. So, or excuse me, July of this year. So because of that, it's kind of hard to move off of it. But, you know, if Matt Rhule is looking for a reset, if he has looked at these last 2 years and thinks, you know, this needs to look different, maybe they do want to go outside. Maybe he does want to try to do something differently. But as it had been expressed to me more than on one occasion, Matt Rhule's the kind of guy that likes to work with people before he elevates them into those kinds of positions. And that kind of has fit the narrative both for Dana Holgorsen and for John Butler. I mean, we go back, he wanted Dana Holgorsen as an analyst before, you know, he ended up here in Lincoln in November, I think in large part because if he was going to make a move, he wanted that guy on staff. I think John Butler, very similar thing. He wanted to work with John Butler before he was ever going to make John Butler the defensive coordinator. I feel like that's what 2024 was. I feel like the end of Tony White in Nebraska was going to be reached here at the end of 2024, almost regardless of how things went. Because they, you know, he was going to have likely opportunities elsewhere, and Nebraska was positioning themselves to potentially replace him in-house. So you just had a seamless transition. The bigger question is, with everything Matt Rhule knows now between 2 years of Big Ten football, does he want to run a lot of this back, or does he want a complete fresh start like he's doing on the offensive side? I mean, those are kind of the big questions to me.
Even up to like 8:30 yesterday, I thought Nebraska could squeeze one more year out of Tony Butler. But having said that, and they clearly can't, is there anything you'd like to see Nebraska continue or change philosophically on defense if, like, you were in the hiring business, Dave?
You know, the hard part for me is that, one, I'm not smart, so that's always difficult. So for me to be able to identify what it is exactly that I'd like to see change is always, you know, really reactionary. So what I'm going to say may not really necessarily fit any real defensive principles. But one of the things that was always difficult is that Nebraska played such off coverage without providing an extra rusher or blitzing or, you know, so you have to, it just feels like you're asking a lot of that defensive line to always be able to generate pressure, because otherwise you're just leaving these easy windows open. I mean, Nebraska allowed so many completions, easy completions throughout the season. I mean, how many times did they have a quarterback who had an under 50% completion percentage? How many times was it under 60? It's a lot lower than you think. And so part of it to me is, can they find a defense that just doesn't allow such easy throws? Like, I feel like teams were able to stay on the field for long stretches against Nebraska simply because of how the secondary principle and coverages were compared to what your defensive line was actually able to do. And I think that makes it really hard, especially in an era where, you know, so much of it is quick passes, get it out, try to get numbers against, you know, wherever you can on the field and go from there.
Schaefer, as you're looking at what you just kind of described with the defensive secondary and some of those things, in that sense, do you understand when you hear, and I've heard a lot of this, I assume you have as well, the fan base being hesitant of elevating John Butler into that role when we didn't necessarily love what we saw from coverages this year?
Yeah, I mean, I definitely understand it, because it's not like you'd be elevating a guy whose group was phenomenal this season.
Has a ton of experience as a DC, to be fair.
Right. And so you're betting on kind of what he did in Buffalo, a little bit of the fact that he has Big Ten experience, the fact that he's a veteran coach. But ultimately, you know, what we know in terms of media and what fans see are just a micro fraction of what happens behind the scenes. I don't know. Like, I've never had the chance to just sit down and pick John Butler's brain. He might be a really, really smart defensive guy. I have no way of knowing that. Mm-hmm. You know, the presentation of how the program is presented, we don't know that much about John Butler. We really don't. And so to say that we do is just an outright lie, or you're someone who's able to traverse those circles in a way that most media and fans aren't. And so, you know, from what I have heard, he's a really intelligent, successful defensive backs coach. I think it'd be hard to just judge him on this season alone. And ultimately, you know, I'm going to put my trust in the idea that Matt Rhule is going to pick a defensive coordinator that aligns with his principles and can get similar results to what he's done throughout his career, which he's a defensive-oriented coach. I have a lot more trust in whatever Nebraska is going to do on defense because of Matt Rhule's track record than I do regardless of the name that's going to get mentioned as the defensive coordinator.
Yeah, that's what, you know, that's what I was talking about. Like, Schaefer, I'm with you. You're going to make fun of me. Surprised is too strong of a word. I am a little taken aback given two things that you've already mentioned in this interview that we have talked about for 12 months. Number one, we weren't sure how much longer we were going to get Coach White anyway. Number two, Coach Rhule has a track record of always playing good defense. Like, he surrounded himself with good defensive people. You've referenced both those things during this interview on your own unsolicited. Yet we're here. Go ahead. You make fun of me like, Damon, how long have you been covering Nebraska? I get it. But, man, I trust Coach Rhule. You know what I mean?
Yeah, well, it's hard because you can trust him. Here's how I would sort of parse through it. I trust that he's going to have Nebraska's defense largely playing well, regardless of who his assistants are, because that's sort of been his MO, regardless of where he's at. That is if we were ranking things that I trust in the program, I think Nebraska's defense is almost always going to be averaged, above average, or good as long as Matt Rhule is here. And I think it's going to be more likely above average and good because of who he is and what he has done as a coach. The whole program, the whole team, the whole outlook, you know, I trust what's happening with the defense. I'm not entirely sure that how this is all going to look with Dana Holgorsen, how he's going to marry that offense with his defensive style, how he's going to change as an in-game coach with those two different philosophies. That I have a lot more questions about than what ultimately is going to be Nebraska's defense or who the defensive coordinator is. I have a lot of blind faith that they're still going to be pretty good defensively, in equal parts because of who will be involved at the top and Matt Rhule. And also, it's the Big Ten Conference. It's not like you're facing the best offenses in college football. It's not like you're getting a ton of innovation or even the best athletes in college football. Sometimes you're going to get Jackson Stratton and you're going to get an Iowa team that has no business playing in 2024 offensively, and you're going to benefit from that. Like, that's the reality of Big Ten football. And that's why I think Nebraska's defense will be fair to good most of the time. Also, in part, because Matt Rhule has been a good defensive coordinator.
That's Mike Schaefer of Husker 24/7. Schaefer, we appreciate it as always. We'll talk to you next week.
Hey, all right, guys.
Hey, tomorrow, Schaefer.
All right, have a good one.
Thanks.
I hope you get to sleep at some point. That's our guy, Schaefer from Husker 24/7. We'll be back. More Hurrdat Sports Radio coming next. We're back here on Hurrdat Sports Radio, AM 590, ESPN Omaha, ESPN Tri-Cities, Camp O'Hara and Lincoln. That's DB. I'm Ravi Lulla here at Hurrdat Sports Bar and Grill. It is time for Bet On It, brought to you by Warhorse Sportsbook, the best place in Nebraska to place your sports bets. It is in Lincoln and in Omaha. Make sure you get out to the casinos and check out warhorsecasino.com for all the house rules and a full list of promotions as well. DB, before we get into it too much, the degenerates were mad that we didn't give any locks yesterday.
I know, man. I've been on a heater.
You have been on a heater. You've been doing good.
Hey, did you give the guys my Ole Miss play?
I did. Yeah. As soon as you hung up, when we got into it the next segment, I gave them Ole Miss, which won again.
Yes. Yes, they did.
TK asked about Cincinnati minus
he
three and a half.
He said something slick earlier. What did he say?
At Villanova. What did TK say?
I got to go.
He's always saying something slick.
Our YouTube chat is off the chain. Every day.
Was it about was it his comment about separate but equal?
No, I missed that one.
Oh, he was.
What did he said, I can't even remember. Of course, the amazing Daniel, because I screwed up the whole.
Snickers Southwest.
So what am I thinking when I say Snickers? What's their thing? Hungry? Or wait, what is it?
Something about getting cranky. Shane, do you know? You know the Snickers slogan?
Something, grab a Snickers.
You're an idiot.
Thank you for that. That's helpful.
What a dummy.
I heard a rumor I was an idiot.
Of course it was Amazing Dan that said something smart.
How do you feel?
I was like, Southwest Snickers, then. I don't know.
It seems like a Steven, actually. Though. Well, actually.
Steven was in early, man.
He was.
Good on him.
Do you like Cincinnati minus 3.5 over Villanova? Do you have a good sense for either of those teams?
On the surface, yes.
I've got a good sense. I don't think Villanova is very good.
I don't think the Big East is very good.
That's entirely possible. The results early have not been kind.
Hey, were you surprised Hurley was like is just going crazy?
No, that's who I've always thought he was.
Man, he's got some different personalities.
So this is part of the reason I have never liked him very much.
So the reason, so here's, can I, let me just get back to the Villanova thing.
Yeah.
It's pretty low.
Yeah, it's 3.5, so it makes me feel a little.
It's pretty low.
Like, I look at that and I go, probably should be.
Because Cincy is the top 15 team.
5.5, 6.5?
Yeah.
Somewhere in there?
I would agree.
You know, that feels like it should be somewhere closer to a 2 or 3 possession game.
Yeah, I wouldn't.
I wouldn't
mess with that.
But stinky line or free money, that's the game we like to play here.
Well.
I think Villanova's very bad. I don't think Kyle Neptune can coach his way out of a paper sack.
Wow. Just continuing the hate.
Dude, Kyle Neptune's not good.
So the only,
it's not slander when it's true.
The one you're going to be right about is Woodson.
Not the one. I'm right about several.
Well, I mean, just a hard line stance.
Yes.
You wouldn't even entertain him being okay.
No.
You just said awful from the jump.
Yeah, Woodson, that was a terrible hire for Indiana. Woodson's terrible. He's been terrible.
Wow.
They continue to
turn
be terrible.
It around on you.
I'll wait for it. I'm not holding my breath.
They covered in their 25th place game the other day.
Hey, good for them, you know. I'm not taking any victory laps for Creighton's 7th place win over Notre Dame.
Yeah.
But at that point, you go 0-2. I don't really care what happens after that.
Well, that was kind of grimy.
Yeah, it's everything's grimy these days.
Yeah.
And I wonder how grimy that Cincinnati-Villanova game is going to be.
Yeah, I'll give you your lock if you want it.
I lean towards free money there, but yeah, I would love a lock. The degenerates need their little cat.
I'll give you two. Take your pick or put them together.
What do we got?
Take Clemson catching 2, maybe 1.5.
Okay.
From a visiting Kentucky bunch.
I've got it at 1.5 right now.
Yep. Take Clemson.
Okay. That's lock number one.
Yeah. And this line has come down quite a bit, but it was big for a reason to open.
Mm-hmm. It's Texas A&M.
How in the world did you know that?
I don't know. It's at 8.5 right now. You're looking at me like you saw a ghost.
No, I am being serious, though. Like, why? What made you say that?
I just kind of was looking at the lines, and that one jumped out to me.
You talking to a ghost?
That's not making a ton of sense with Wake Forest coming in. That just didn't make a lot of sense to me. I was like, I wonder if he's thinking Texas A&M.
Wow.
And then you say it started bigger, and I was like, it's still a pretty big number. It's probably Texas A&M.
I think it opened at 11.
Yeah.
It currently sits at 8.
Yeah. I've got an 8.5, but yeah, somewhere in there.
Listen. I don't even want to say it.
Who you want now?
A&M.
You want A&M?
Yeah, lay the 8.
Okay.
A&M
minus the 8.5, and you like Clemson plus the 1.5.
Yep.
Okay. I see you. You have been on a heater.
I still can't believe that, though. You know, what are we doing?
You know, sometimes you're like, hey, get out of my head. I think that was one of those. It was one of those moments.
What's that?
You look freaked out.
Oh, that's incredible.
Hey, by the way, Doug on the chat line says, you're not when you're hungry. Grab a Snickers is what the Snickers.
You're not you when you're hungry. Yeah.
So that's it. Exactly. I said hungry, grab a Snickers. That's in there.
You just said grab a Snickers, Shane.
I said hungry, which grab
is,
a Snickers.
No, you just said grab a Snickers, which is like, okay, sure. That's fine.
At least Doug has your back. You need, I mean, everybody needs some friends in their corner.
You're not you when you're hungry.
That's totally on me.
TD Pay.
Hot Danger says Hurley is Fran McCaffrey who wins.
He's wild, isn't he?
Yes.
You're kind of vibing with old Hot Danger, huh?
Yeah, it's not
I
wrong.
Need everybody to calm down. My heartburn is still a thing.
Man, you need to get some. Need to get some Pepto or something in there.
No, man.
Heartburn? Grab a Snickers.
I don't think that'll
help.
That's
not it, Shane.
I don't think that'll help. That's actually really funny, Hot Danger. That might be my favorite comment so far this week.
No, there's been some good ones.
There's been some good
Tiana
ones.
Tiana wants to phrase. She wants to.
To use your phrase.
My T-shirt, my phrase.
Yeah.
I don't even know why I said that. It's just how I feel.
I don't remember what it was even.
I said I'm a conduit for perspective.
Oh, yeah. You were saying it because we were mad at people who were just out here wilding.
Well, and I think, I was really saying that because people are asking me my thoughts on things without really realizing, like, where I am in the middle of it.
Yeah, the position you're in.
Yeah.
Which is.
And I'm like, that's okay. Like, I'm going to own. I'm going to eat it. I'm like, I'm just going to be a conduit for perspective.
You're in a weird spot, to say the least.
Yeah.
If you.
It's one.
I'm going to ask you.
That's fine.
I'm going to ask you a question that you may or may not like for bet on it.
Okay. I always like when you preface it. It's disarming.
I know. That's why I do it.
It's a wrong question.
Let's not do that anymore. I like my natural response, whatever that is.
Yeah.
Bill, Chris, and Tosh might, but.
I don't know. I'm trying to keep us on the air.
It's fine.
I'm going to ask you the same question I asked Mike J. Schaefer.
Is that it for bet on it?
No, this is part of it. This is just this is not a line per se, but I'd like you to bet on this. If you had to bet on it today, internal stay with John Butler, external they hire from outside for DC. Just your gut. Not the heartburn gut. Let's clear that up. We don't want any extra acid in there.
Okay, ask me again.
If you had to bet on it, internally, they move John Butler to D.C., or they go outside, hire somebody else at 9:37 on a Tuesday. Knowing full well that circumstances can change.
They go outside.
I would tend to agree.
They go outside.
I also think, though, that means John Butler's not here next year. That's the next step, I think.
You're like, I want to say so many bad things.
Do them. Let them rip.
It's not 2025 yet.
Say what you got to say.
2025, we'll be able to say whatever we want to, and nobody will bat an eye at it.
Is that your New Year's resolution? Talk crazier to me in 2025?
No, like I'm still going to try to have self-control and be rational.
Yeah.
Although I just peeked at my ankles, and they're so ashy, it's not even funny.
You like, rocking the KD this morning?
Oh, my gosh.
Hopefully you're not going to get a shot from game day today. Otherwise, they might give you a hard time.
I saw her yesterday. She was coming. I didn't think she was there, and so I was just waiting for Chris because he's looking at some other stuff for me. And she came in, and she had a cup, and I didn't look at it.
Yeah.
And she goes, ugh. Is this going to be my first blood draw of the day?
Uh-oh.
I was like, dang, hi to you too. I was like, where are you coming from? And she looked at me, and she had a cup in her hand, and she goes, Scooters? Like, I
went somewhere else totally in my mind with that cup.
I was like, I couldn't. Number one, I can't see.
Yeah.
I certainly wasn't paying attention.
I can't read.
Yeah, and I said, hey, I'm just letting you know, Ravi said you missed, and she was livid.
She did.
Best wishes with that one.
Yeah, I know. I'm glad I don't have to go back for a couple weeks to get another blood draw. I needed to forget about that before I go back.
And as far as to say, dude, ruined my day, I don't miss. And she nailed mine. I was a gusher.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Got to be careful there.
I know.
You heard it here first. DB guarantees they'll go outside the family for a TC.
Yeah, that's all I need.
That's Bet On It, brought to you by War Horse Sportsbook. We'll be back to wrap up the show next. Wrapping up the show here on Hurrdat Sports Radio, AM 590, ESPN Omaha, ESPN Tri-Cities, KFOR in Lincoln. That's DB. I'm Ravi Lulla. We are joined now by Ryan Clarke, who covers Oregon for the Oregonian. Ryan, how are you this morning?
Great, guys. How's it going?
All right, good, good. Well, I appreciate you joining us early again. It's like, I know every time you see us pop up, you're like, oh, my gosh, these guys are in the Midwest.
I've been on early in sports radio in Oregon, so nothing new there as far as timing goes, but I guess that's part of being in the Big Ten now, so.
Appreciate it.
Yeah, it's not just the travel that everybody talks about. It's the early wake-up calls from Midwestern radio stations. Ryan, it's kind of funny, this Oregon season, the only team to end up undefeated for the year. But, you know, if you had checked in with national media, I'm guessing local media and fans as well at various points throughout the season, whether it's a all too close for comfort wins to start the year against Idaho and Boise State, whether it's sneaking by a Wisconsin team that's not very good. It seems like despite all the success, people have had question marks about Oregon for most of the year. Is that fair?
I think it's fair to a degree, for sure. They are still undefeated. They are still the number one team in the country, and they are, I think, still one of the deepest and most experienced teams in the country. But yeah, I mean, within those wins, there have been questions and there have been things for Oregon to improve on. But at the end of the day, if those issues, however glaring they might be, are popping up and you're still winning games, that's a good sign for your culture. And I think that that's what a lot of the success that Oregon's had this year has come down to, is their culture. This isn't, you know, the Marcus Mariota-led Oregon teams of old where they have these incredible superstar players like Marcus. It's a collection of talented players and certainly future NFL players, but guys that I think are bought into what Dan Lanning is preaching, and that has been central to their success. Now, obviously, they're talented, they're experienced, but the culture piece is why they've been able to weather these storms in games against inferior opponents along the way, and then obviously got big wins along the way as well against Ohio State on the road at Michigan and others.
So it's interesting too, because I said at the beginning, and I wasn't even really thinking of Oregon as the poster child, but I said even amongst the elite, the teams that are most connected internally will be the teams to be there at the end. So I'm thinking, at that time, it was Notre Dame. I had referenced Clemson because of their lack of wanting to kind of bring in, quote-unquote,
this is, you know, not my words, this is Sweeney, mercenaries for the program. And I even looked at schools like Penn State. I almost looked at Oregon as a little more of the other way, like very good NIL, can acquire talent at will. But I undersold Lanning's, his ability to kind of mesh and meld. Would that be accurate, or would you have not put them in that mold to start the season as well?
I think that that's an outside perception that a lot of folks share, right, is the idea that Oregon is this big, you know, NIL powerhouse that that acquires talent in that way and just sees what happens. But I do think that in many ways, folks, myself included, even prior to the season, had overlooked the culture aspect and thought, yeah, you know, Dan Lanning has given these inspiring speeches before, but, you know, he was 0-3 against Washington. They had lost some big games along the way. They had a great record, yes, and they were building something pretty substantial in Eugene, but this was the ultimate prove-it season for Dan Lanning in that regard. I mean, you bring in as many transfers as they did on both sides of the ball. It's not easy by any stretch to get those guys to mesh, to buy in, and to play good football. And this Oregon team now, compared to where they were those first couple of shaky weeks against Idaho and Boise State, the growth is evident on and off the field. And I think that that credit obviously goes to Dan Lanning, but also to these players for, you know, coming together the way they did and sort of bucking that narrative, right? Mm. That Oregon is just this flashy place with, you know, these guys got paid and now they're good to just do whatever. They want to win, and they want to win for each other. And that's evident not just when Dan Lanning speaks, but when you talk to these guys in this locker room.
We're talking with Ryan Clarke covering Oregon for the Oregonian. Ryan, as you kind of look at past the Big Ten championship game, and I know that the team isn't doing that, but we have that luxury as media members. Oregon's in the playoff one way or the other. How do you like the way their chances stack up to survive this first ever expanded playoff?
I think like anybody else, it's obviously dependent on health and, you know, keeping their key players healthy. And they are a deep team. They are a team that has been able to weather injuries to key players. You think about a guy like Jordan Birch, their top pass rusher, has missed a bunch of games this year. And in his place, a sophomore, Mateo Uyangalele, the brother of DJ. I mean, he's 10 and a half sacks this year. He's had an incredible season, and he's only 19 years old. And, you know, they have the depth to weather those issues, and they also, I think, have the luck of entering the playoff with not a lot of major injuries on their team. There's really no major injuries other than a couple of offensive linemen who are dinged up, which is just part of the game. So I think they're built for the long term, and I think that obviously, despite some narratives in the media that might be out there, they want to win this Big Ten championship game and get that bye, no matter what the hypothetical path would be for the five seed, because you win this conference, you get to the Rose Bowl. That's a place Oregon's been many times over the years and is comfortable playing in, and is not a very long flight from Eugene. And so get there, and you only have to win three games in this expanded playoff to go win a national championship. And I think they know they're going to play a great team along the way, and they're not worried about the path.
Ryan, how much of I always kind of look at quarterbacks and are they or are they aren't an extension of their head coach, and kind of from a leadership standpoint, how convenient is it or ironic is it that Gabriel gets a lot of the questions that like maybe a Lanning does or the culture part of Oregon does, where you look at him statistically and you're like, oh yeah, he's pretty good, .. But, and then there's like a fill in the blank and he just keeps winning. How much of that is just like, yeah, I mean, it's just kind of a microcosm of Oregon and more importantly, how you got to where you are, because that is how people think, even though it is productive.
Yeah, I mean, he's been incredibly efficient, incredibly productive, and a leader in the locker room. And one of the more cerebral guys I've been around in this sport, too, just somebody that he likes to wax philosophical about what it means to be a connected team and to go out there and fight with your brothers. And that's not something that you see with everybody. You might see it more often with quarterbacks than others just because of the role they play. But You know, DG is that guy for this team. These dudes rally around him. He's not just some guy that waltzed in and is the big star and everybody sort of, you know, looks the other way. He's in his sixth year of college football, too. You got to remember, like, this guy has been around the block, played at UCF, played at Oklahoma, you know, played in big games all over the country. And so, you know, the stage is not too bright for this guy. And I think that even amid some of the question moments for him this year, whether it's a dangerous throw into traffic or, you know, a red zone interception or whatever, like, minute criticism folks might have, he's otherwise been incredibly efficient and been exactly what they've needed, you know, to replace Bo Nix and to elevate this team with all the weapons they have around them.
Ryan, before I let you go here, I got to ask, because I'm sort of just fascinated by Oregon and their ability to sort of hire coaches in a way that no one really else does that has their money. If you look at the guys they hire, Dan Lanning included, none of them outside of Willie Taggart were a sitting head coach when it happened. And most of them had no successful experience coaching as head coaches in college football, certainly not at the power level. Like, is there some secret sauce there you can share with the rest of us? Because it blows me away as I look. I mean, you go all the way back to – it's all of them. You go Rich Brooks, you go Bilotti, you go Chip Kelly, you go Helfrich, you go Cristobal, you go Dan Lanning. They're all just these guys that they found, and not that they didn't have good pedigrees, but it's kind of ridiculous.
It is pretty remarkable, and I think underrated in a lot of ways, because folks, you know, don't think about the long-term history of Oregon. They just think about, oh, yeah, remember Chip Kelly, remember DeAnthony Thomas and all the fast guys they had on those Oregon offenses. That was fun, wasn't it? But yeah, you look at Oregon's history, they've got a lot of great coaches, but from Bilotti to Rich Brooks and all those guys you mentioned. And I don't know if it's as much of a secret sauce as it is, you know, there's always a little bit of luck sprinkled in there when you have the right circumstances to hire a coach. Obviously, Lanning rising at Georgia just at the right time for Oregon to bring him in after what I think was a scary stretch for the Oregon football program. It looked like Washington and others in the Pac-12 were starting to pass them up and that they were on, you know, shaky ground. But they've made the right hires at the right times, and it's allowed this program to elevate from the mid-90s till now. And in the last 30 years, they've become a blue blood. And the reason for that is, yes, they've hired great coaches, but, you know, they've proven it on the field, and they've got the institutional backing from Phil Knight, Nike, and everything that has laid the foundation that the players have built on.
That's Ryan Clarke from the Oregonian. Ryan, we appreciate the time as always, and enjoy the game this weekend.
Thanks, Ryan.
Absolutely. Yep, thanks, guys.
Before we let you go, I got to let you know, if you're trying to lose weight, I know it can be tough, but you don't have to do it alone. Midlands Family Urgent Care offers affordable weight loss medications designed to work with your body and help you see real results. They've got holiday specials on tirzepatide and semaglutide, both treatments that are backed by science and proved long-term results with proper use. Give them a call, 402-679-0943, to make an appointment at their Millard location to get started today. That's DB. I'm Ravi Lulla. We'll be back tomorrow with more Hurrdat Sports Radio.